What I would favor is moving in March and then watching, measuring, being very careful about what we see ahead of us.
A host of Fed officials speaking throughout the week, with Senator Manchin calling on the Fed to get moving, saying the following: it's time for the Federal Reserve to tackle inflation head on. We all have a responsibility to do all that is possible to roll back inflation and manage our debts. The longer we or the Federal Reserve wait to act, the more economic pain will be caused. Let's get to Bloomberg's Mike McKee for more. Morning, Mike.
Good morning, John. Well, it's a week of what normally would be considered secondary indicators, but they take on new weight given the emphasis on the Fed these days. For example, what does PPI tell us about the possibility of future inflation? We will find out tomorrow. We also get the Empire Manufacturing Index. On Wednesday, retail sales. Did Americans start slowing their spending in January? There's a feeling that they did. We'll see how that translates. Import prices, of course, oil is going to affect that one. And on Wednesday as well, the Fed minutes, Neel Kashkari speaking, but it's the Fed minutes that will attract attention because people want to know what they talked about in terms of a 50 basis point move in March and the balance sheet reduction. Is there any more information on that? Thursday, jobless claims, as usual, building permits, the Philly Fed. And then Loretta Mester, we haven't heard from her since the day before the CPI report came out. She wasn't in favor of 50 then. Is she now? And then on Friday, three Fed officials, Charlie Evans, Waller, Christopher Waller, and John Williams. It'll be really interesting to see Waller and Williams because they both vote, see what they are thinking should be done. Over the weekend, as you mentioned, we heard from Mary Daly. She doesn't want to be too aggressive. And we also heard from Esther George, who thinks that we don't need an intermeeting move, as Jim Bullard had suggested we might, and maybe we should sell assets from the balance sheet to move things along. So the Fed is starting to weigh in on what should be done, but so far no real change in strategy from them. Why are they not embracing Joe Manchin's argument? Well, I want to show you this. Inflation for 2021 was 7%. They added in not just the wages and salaries that you made, but all the money the government sent to people. And in that case, it shows that real income for Americans grew 7.6%, for the bottom 50%, 11.7%, 9% for the top 10%. Only the folks in the middle did worse last year, and they were the ones who were about the cutoff level for government aid. So it may not be as bad as Senator Manchin thinks out there.
Mike McKee, thank you. Let's hope it gets better. That's something we can all agree on. Goldman cut their forecast on the S&P 500 to 4,900 from 5,100. The chief equity strategist, David Costin, said this: the macro backdrop this year is considerably more challenging than in 21. Uncertainty abounds regarding the path of inflation and policy. Oksana Aronoff, Peter Cicchini, Stuart Kaiser back with us. Stuart, I want to come to you. When Goldman put out their call for 5,100 on the S&P, they were looking for two hikes this year. They now look for seven. That's a move on valuations, not on earnings. And I wonder from Stu whether you've thought about making a similar move for this year.
I mean, look, from our perspective, John, the risks were going to be concentrated in the front half of the year, just for the reasons you're seeing now, I think, which was, you know, the forward growth outlook was going to be decelerating and inflation hadn't yet peaked. So, you know, our view was that you had kind of front-loaded risks and front-loaded volatility. You know, now that you've added, you know, added additional rate cuts into market pricing, I think that that's just become even more acute. So you know, strategists and the market are starting to kind of adjust, I think, not only their expectation for valuation, but also the timing of that valuation. You know, I think you could argue that the second half, you know, could look actually fairly bullish if the Fed gets a couple of hikes off and then inflation decelerates in the second half at the rate we expect. So I think kind of what you're seeing here is a moving around of not only the level of valuation in the forecast, but also the timing and when people expect these things to happen. But certainly our work has shown, you know, considerable downside risk, particularly to valuation in NASDAQ and the tech sector. And I don't think there's any reason to assume that that wouldn't apply to other markets as well.
Pete, just your thoughts on that as well, how you'd have to adjust your call on multiples, given how much more we've priced into this Fed curve.
Yeah, no, I think, you know, 17 times on the S&P makes a lot of sense to me in a seven hike environment, could even be lower. And what happens to earnings? Well, you know, one of the reasons why we've been cautious since late last year, and especially on small caps, is because we thought that guides would worsen. When you have producer prices as high as they are relative to consumer prices, it's difficult for smaller companies in particular to pass that along through to their customers. And so, you know, we have that dynamic going on for smaller companies and the duration dynamic going on for larger tech companies that have really been sustaining the rally for so long. So I think it's kind of a double whammy, whether you're looking at small caps or large caps. I think the headwinds are there no matter how you slice it.
Oksana, just to turn to you, some of the work Goldman did in this report over the weekend was actually pretty interesting just on what happens to equities when growth decelerates and real yields rise. How does credit respond? Typically, what does fixed income look like in a backdrop, with a backdrop, where growth decelerates and real yields pick up?
Not a happy combination for credit. But I do actually want to make a comment as well, just broadly on the market before we come back to credit. I think it's important to remember what the technicals in this market look like. We have a generation of investors now across the board, equities and fixed income, that only know a market where the Fed reverses every single sell-off. 10 million people, I believe, opened a brokerage account for the first time during the pandemic. Something like 41% of U.S. household financial assets are now in the stock market. And the same if we cross over to bonds, right? We have a whole generation of investors that really have never had to deal with a market that does anything but go up in terms of returns. So these are all really important technical pressures to keep in mind, as well as the fact that, you know, there's a lot of talk about the flatness of the curve between the midpoint and the 10-year. And that is definitely true. But also, let's not forget that between the Fed funds rate and twos right now, the last time we had a spread this wide was mid-2004, and it was followed by something like 15 to 17 hikes consecutively. So we really are in uncharted territory here. And whether we have a continuation of these rising rates or whether we have something that is causing, you know, spread risk to widen, which so far returns have been really driven by interest rate risk. Even if you look at high yield, that has been down year to date. What has led it on the downside? The highest quality part of that market. Double Bs are down significantly more than triple Cs. So this is not a fundamental story right now. And I predict that it's not going to be for a while. This is not going to be a year where fundamentals necessarily matter, particularly in the first half. It's going to be, you know, easy gains of 21 may be taken away very easily as all tide that lifted all boats may now, you know, crash them, so to speak. But fundamentals are important to watch, but I think high correlations across a variety of sectors are much more important. Technicals are much more important, and it is really crucial to have that liquidity in portfolios.
Oksana, difficult to answer this with a yes or no. You can expand on it a little bit later, but if you can, yes or no, are you expecting a repeat of Q4 18?
I think closer to a yes than a no. Yes.
We'll pick up on that. Oksana Aronoff alongside Peter Cicchini and Stuart Keiser. Coming up on the program, the morning calls and later, equities recover this morning as it seems the tone has softened just a little bit, relatively speaking, over in Ukraine and Russia. We can talk about that through the program from New York.
A digital world demands digital currencies. Unlock the potential of Bitcoin with Grayscale Bitcoin Trust, the world's largest Bitcoin investment vehicle. Go digital. Go Grayscale.
When you think space, you probably think one space agency that travels under the radar is ESA, which is surprising considering what the European Space Agency has achieved and how vital it is to the global space industry.
We've collaborated with pretty much everybody who is involved in space exploration.
ESA wants to be a leading force in furthering humanity's mission into space.
Commander Ground, do you copy?
Copy.
If we want to have successful human missions to Mars, we are going to have to learn to live and work off-world in a different way. And the place where we are going to learn to do that is on the Moon.
Can ESA help humanity take its next giant leap?
stocked early enough all these precious materials you were just mentioning. And we were on the lucky side that our prognosis was spot on in a way, forecasting what kind of material we would need and what quantity we would need.
Five minutes away from the opening bow, two words, all right. That's all it took, the Russian president just to say all right in a response to his foreign minister proposing further diplomatic talks with the West. All right, enough to lift this equity market as well. Just negative a tenth of 1%, turning around, reversing earlier losses on the S&P 500. We were down by more than one full percentage point. Switch at the board and get to the bond market. We turn around there as well at the front end. Very much so. Up 9 basis points on twos, pushing 160. On twos right now, 158.46. That's the bond market, the price action. Here the morning calls. JP Morgan upgrading Goodyear Tire to overweight $23 price target. The analyst highlighting an attractive valuation with deep value for patient investors. We're up there by almost 4%. Wedbush upgrading Micron to outperform 120 price target, growing more optimistic about pricing amid increasing demand, up there by 1.6%. And Jefferies finally downgrading JP Morgan to a hold, warning about increasing competition for loans and deposits. That stock down by 6 or 7 tenths of 1%. Coming up, geopolitical tensions front and center. Your equity market recovers going into the opening bell. The cash open is up next. This is Bloomberg.
Energy prices and a short supply of key chemicals that produce synthetic fertilizers are sending pig, cow and horse manure prices soaring. Even human waste is in demand as farmers hunt for alternatives. Fertilizer helps increase crop yields.
You can see how much moisture is held into this. It's a lot of organic material into the compost. It breaks down, the manure and the straw breaks down into a friable mix that can be mixed into your soil in the ground and for growing a whole range of different vegetables. Holds the nutrients in, holds the water in, and it really increases the kind of biodynamic profile of the soil.
The recent price spike could mean more farmers going organic for the long term.
Market that over the past few weeks has made it clear it wants to go higher. It got a little spooked by the idea that geopolitical tensions are rising.
I came in early this morning. The market was down about 1%. We turn around off the back of headlines out of Russia. Futures now down just 0.1%. On the Russell, we're positive by 0.25%. On the Nasdaq, we're negative just 0.25%. A big turnaround off the back of some headlines out of Moscow. Would it stick? There's the opening bell. Switch on the board and get to the bond market. Almost 190 at the lows on tens. Then we bounce back towards 198.58. Yields were coming down. Now they're rising again, up 5 basis points, closing in on 2%. On twos, a big turnaround there too. If you look at a two-year yield, we are higher at the front end by 9 basis points now. 159, round it up to 160. We're getting back to levels we pushed through last week, Thursday into Friday morning. In the FX market, euro dollar 113.13, negative 0.33%, and crude backing away, 0.06%, down about 60 cents to 92.47. As we open up this market, about 30 seconds in, we are down by almost 0.1% on the S&P 500, leaving behind some of the drama of the second half of Friday's session and earlier this morning. Energy, bottom of the pile, down 0.6%. Utilities, staples, defensive here, top of the pile. That's where the outperformance is, at 0.4%. Breaking down some of the numbers in this market, about a minute in. Let's get to Abby for more. Hey, Abby.
Hey, John. Well, on all of these shifting headlines around Russia-Ukraine tensions, lots of volatility beneath the surface as well. In fact, big turnarounds both to the upside and the downside, turning higher the airlines earlier when there was a lot of pressure around the Russia-Ukraine tensions. Airlines down more than 2%. Now some of the big airlines up more than 1%. On the other hand, last week, as these tensions escalated, big oil had rallied in a big way. Now oil down, also supporting the idea that the pressure is decreasing. Also on airlines, interesting, there was a headline not so long ago that unruly travelers are pushing airlines and the U.S. government toward a no-fly list. Perhaps that is a part of the gains as well. As for defense contractors, they had been higher earlier, now off of the lows, but nonetheless lower. So that suggests that investors are a little bit more optimistic about those geopolitical tensions. Where investors remain unoptimistic, John, big tech, Apple and Amazon lower. Of course, rates are higher. And Bullard was not so long ago reiterating a hawkish view. So, of course, those big tech names are dragging on the equity indexes, John.
Abby, thank you. Been itching to get back to Oksana Aronoff on her comments about 10 minutes ago on whether we could get a repeat of Q4 2018. Oksana, let me come back to you. You've got more time now, as much time as you like. Do you see a flavor of it, something close to it? What are you looking for here?
Are we talking equities or credit?
We're talking credit. No. We're talking credit. And I think if I remember correctly, it was about 100 basis points of spread widening in a blink of an eye in Q4 18. No issuance in the primary market from high yield. It was a really rough time. Are you looking for that?
Well, we're already halfway there, are we not? We're already halfway there, and we haven't really begun to feel the pain of any Fed hikes yet. We haven't really begun to feel the pain of any fundamental issues associated with higher borrowing costs, which, of course, are most important to these lowest quality borrowers. We haven't really begun to feel the pain from any geopolitical, you know, risk coming to fruition. Right now, they are simply risks. So there are a lot of unknowns out there. So absolutely, we could get there and then some very quickly. One of the big, and you and I have talked about this at length over the years, one of the big differences in the market and credit market today is the absence of street liquidity, which has been more than amply fulfilled by Fed liquidity. But with the Fed liquidity going away, you really do not have a shock absorption mechanism in this market, which is why you can experience, you know, what can feel like recessionary price movements without even an actual recession. We saw that in 2018. We saw that in 2015, 2016, with parts of the market that had nothing to do with oil that was really experiencing the brunt of the issues, right? So this market is on precarious footing from a liquidity standpoint. So absolutely, we can get there and then some.
Oksana, when you think about coming out of cash again then, the indicators from the previous cycle, I assume, are different this time around, given that you believe the durability of the Fed put a shift did. I think we can all agree on that to some extent, to some degree. Oksana, what would encourage you back in? What are the conditions that you'd look for to redeploy that cash?
At least a positive real return for areas of the market like high yield. And we are not even there yet with these most speculative parts of the market, right? So that, I think, is benchmark number one, if you will. And then absolutely, we could go 200 wider from here, and that would be an interesting level to start getting involved. But ultimately, of course, it's all dependent on how do, you know, valuations, fundamentals, and technicals line up. If we continue to see an increase in, or continue to see an acceleration to the inflation number, that plank is going to move higher. If we can start to see a deceleration to that number, you know, we will readjust accordingly. But right now, this is definitely not a point in time where valuations or technicals or fundamentals look ripe to get involved here.
And Peter Cicchini, just plug that in to your equity story. Let's just imagine that Oksana's world is the world that materializes. We could be 200 basis points wider here in credit. What would that mean to you?
Well, her world is our world, and I was just kind of curious if we were somehow reading off the same script. Look, we've already seen high yield CDX, for example, go from 109 to 105.5. And John, I'm going to put your question off for a second because I wanted to build on something she said in the last segment, which is to say we are not only looking at technical factors relative to central bank policy, but the Fed is at the end of a 40-year secular trend to the zero bound. And not only does it have that secular zero bound termination, if you will, but it's also got a cyclical problem, which is inflation, and it's 5% behind on its typical prescription for rate hikes, the Taylor rule. And so it really is between this rock and hard place, which is going to make the Fed saving the day very, very difficult and makes, I think, equities most vulnerable because of that dynamic, which is a generation of investors has come to expect the Fed to save the day. And the last point to make there is, not only is the Fed in this very precarious position, but the fiscal stimulus, $6 trillion of it, has largely worked its way through the system. And we can see that through personal savings. We can see that through the Treasury General Account. So both fiscal policy as well as monetary policy are now somewhat on the sidelines. And really what we need is organic growth, which I think the transition towards organic growth in this inflationary environment is going to be very, very difficult. So that is not a great setup for risk, whether it's high yield credit in the traditional sense, corporate credit, or equities. There are areas of the market that are interesting. Collateralized cash flowing assets for us are the place to be. And we think there are going to be opportunities there a little bit later in the year to take advantage of the environment.
Stuart, you've been listening to this through the last couple of minutes. Your response, please, your reaction.
My reaction to I don't know that I have a good reaction. There's a lot of information there, Jonathan. I think our view here is there are still significant downside risks to valuation if you get the continued kind of repricing and hawkish expectations of the Fed. And, you know, that's probably most acute in tech. In terms of opportunities, I think the area we've seen clients most recently engaged in is services spending. So there's, you know, the view that both economic growth and inflation will kind of transfer from good spending into services. And I think we've seen a lot of traction in terms of investors trying to go in that direction. So I think big picture, we've had a lot of de-risking. You can see that in the amount of put open interest in the market. And folks that are invested, I think to Peter's point in the previous section, were that a lot of stock picking, a lot of single stock and single credit analysis being done, and a lot of focus on themes such as services spending that investors hope is a little bit insulated from the macro headwinds that we're facing.
A ton of earnings, too. 80% of the S&P 500 earnings story is in. Let's get to Kaylee for more. Hey, Kaylee.
Hey, John. Yeah, we're in the waning days of earnings season now. About 360 companies in the S&P 500 have reported, and by and large, they've been beating expectations to the tune of about 6% on EPS, only about 3% for sales. But where growth has stacked up so far is near 27%. That is a lot better than analysts had expected before earnings season started. A month ago today, when J.P. Morgan kicked things off, estimates were for 21% growth, and they've been continually ratcheted up as we've moved through the season. Of course, it isn't over yet, though, John. We still have about 140 reports to get through, and it's retailers that are going to be in the spotlight over the coming days. It starts with Walmart, which will report on Thursday, then Home Depot, Macy's, Lowe's, TJX, all reporting next week. Target will round things out the week following, and a key focus for this quarter, as it was last quarter, will be on margins. Costs for these companies have been going up due to supply-side challenges from freight to labor, all of that costing more money, and they aren't necessarily passing all of that on to the consumer, because these players, if you exercise too much pricing power, you could risk ceding ground to competitors, especially with wage growth in the U.S. not keeping pace with inflation. Consumers may be getting less tolerant of those higher prices, a little bit pickier about how and where they shop. So that could weigh on the profitability of these companies as we get their reports in the next weeks or so.
Kelly Lyons, thank you. Let's stay on the margin story just briefly. David Costin at Goldman Sachs dropped his forecast. We talked about that earlier. They go from 5,100 to 4,900. This is on valuations and not earnings. What's going to drive earnings, though? Sales growth? or margins. They say sales growth, revenue growth, and not margins. And that's what I want to come to you on, Stuart Keiser. Just your margins call for this year for the S&P, your thoughts around that story, how it played out in 21, and whether that gives you any clues on how things play out in 22.
Well, I think fourth quarter earnings sort of followed that path, Jonathan. We saw a larger beat in revenue expectations than we might have expected, and probably a little bit lower of a beat on the margin side. So, you know, that again, that played out in 4Q, and it seems like the setup for 1Q is similar. You know, the street has not taken up numbers yet, and the mix of revenue versus margin is obviously going to kind of be a key focus of that earnings season as well. So, you know, I wouldn't disagree with it. I think that's how we finished last year, and it does seem that that's like the direction we're going to go in to start this year. How tolerant the market, you know, investors will be to kind of, you know, pressure on margins, we'll see. But it, you know, it strikes me that is not generally the mix of earnings growth that investors are looking for.
Pete, I want to come to you on the same question if I can.
Yeah, no, we're taking a little bit of a different view here, Jonathan. From the perspective that input costs have continued to rise, and that commodity prices have done the same, with geopolitical tensions obviously not helping. We've seen, you know, aluminum above 3,000 for some time now. Nickel, oil, you name it. Lumber is back up above $1,200 per thousand board foot. So I don't see it abating anytime soon. And I think, you know, importantly, the idea that companies can pass through those costs to consumers, I think is just, it's misplaced over the longer term. And while companies have been beating expectations, it's really important to look at guidance. And Bloomberg actually has a great function for that. And net revisions on guidance have been as negative as they have been since 2015. And I think that's mostly on price and on margins, based on the transcripts that we've poured over.
Pete, always going to catch up. Peter Cicchini and Stuart Keiser, and to the wonderful Oksana Aronoff on this fixed income market with some scary thoughts to get your head around for credit, maybe in the not-too-distant future. In the bond market right now, very close to 160 on twos. Yields picking up by 9 basis points to 159.90 at the highs, 159.28 right now. We'll keep an eye on that. Coming up, Wall Street getting back to work as Democrats continue pushing their agenda.
The number of hospitalizations is still very high. The number of cases is still very, very high. But it is going down quickly.
What's happening on Wall Street?
It's the basic law of economics.
The Fed is telling us this is transitory.
Need to catch up?
This is Bloomberg Wall Street Week. I'm David Westin.
We've got the information and insights.
David, you just hit the nail right on the head.
From businesses most influential and instrumental.
And that's the way you run good risk management.
But we need to invest in our systems.
Bloomberg Wall Street Week premieres Friday with replays all weekend on Bloomberg Television and Radio.
We know that it's highly transmissible. We know that two doses of vaccines, Pfizer vaccine specifically, neutralize the virus, but not as efficiently, because various studies showing that reduction up to 40-fold, meaning that a third dose is a must for it to successfully neutralize the variant. What we don't know is still that what are the effects of mix and matching between vaccines, and what are the capabilities of antibodies produced from this mix and matching in neutralizing Omicron? Because as we know, many parts of the world use different types of vaccines. And that would be a great data to look at. It will be also great to look at, because majority of the studies done uses a small sample number, and most of the time when you translate it to real world, the data changes. So it will be really good to look at large scale data of the ability of antibodies from vaccines to neutralize this variant. Grateful here today that the virus Omicron variant still uses ACE2 receptor as its main entry. It means that all of the vaccines which are designed with spike in mind still works. Imagine if it uses a different receptor other than ACE2. None of the vaccines would work today. So I think that is the best news that we got from all these studies which came recently, the past couple of days.
Front Row, exclusive interviews with the most influential figures in finance. Lloyd Blankfein.
Deflation is a terrible thing. Inflation you could tolerate.
Kathy Wood.
Tesla will be in the pole position to dominate.
Jeremy Grantham.
We've had a very, very abnormal honeymoon Goldilocks period.
First available on the Bloomberg Terminal, then on Bloomberg Television and Bloomberg.com. Front Row, the best seats in the house for business's greatest minds.
The number of hospitalizations is still very high. The number of cases is still very, very high. But it is going down quickly. So I think in a few weeks, hopefully, we'll be in a much, much better place. And I think that, you know, as those cases and hospitalizations go down, we'll be able to do more and more.
The U.S. workforce returning to Wall Street amid declining virus cases, a stark contrast to Hong Kong. The hospital's authority chief manager saying the following: the number of confirmed patients has been growing rapidly and by multiples over the past 2 days. The emergency wards at different public hospitals have been severely overloaded. This, of course, will have consequences for the global economy, a multi-speed global economy right now. Mike McKee, good morning to you.
Good morning, John. Yeah, it's why we can't get over this pandemic around the world, because new hotspots keep popping up. At least this is still the Omicron variant, as far as we know, in Hong Kong, but over 2,000 cases a day now in the former British colony. And that has taxed the hospital system, as you mentioned, 90% occupancy in their ICU units. They're not the only ones. South Korea is now going to be offering a fourth shot to immunocompromised patients in the hope of keeping down an outbreak there. And anti-vaccine protests have broken out in Wellington, New Zealand, similar to the ones we saw in Canada last week. Now, the Canadian one is over. They have cleared the last protesters off that Ambassador Bridge that goes between Detroit and Windsor. That is good news. It carries over a couple hundred million dollars a day in trade back and forth between the two economies. So having that back open is good news for the overall economy. Here in New York, you might have noticed that some mask mandates and things changed late last week over the weekend. Now we see Goldman Sachs and JP Morgan have dropped their mask mandates amid an easing in the COVID regulations, trying to get people back to work. A lot of the city's top financial firms starting the great return. City workers due back today. JP Morgan, Goldman, Bank of America in progress. Amex setting a March 1st date. Wells says they'll come back in mid-March, and you can see the rise from a big drop to about 25% now back to work in New York. That's still obviously quite low, and we've got to get that up higher to help the New York City economy recover.
There's going to be a massive push on Wall Street. Mike McKee, thank you. Thank you very much. I want to turn to Bloomberg's Joe Matthew down in D.C. for some of this and to talk about policy too. Joe, can we just start with the shift we've seen in blue states over the last couple of weeks? I've had the conversation, I'm sure you have too. Is it driven by politics or is it driven by the science?
Maybe something in between, Jonathan. It is interesting to see that these Democratic-led states, these northeastern states, get ahead of the White House on this, whether you're talking about Connecticut or even in Virginia, purple Virginia, where this has been a much more controversial matter with school districts suing to maintain mask mandates here. But it's interesting, Jonathan, it comes up at the White House, and you and I have talked about this before. The White House is a step behind on this because the CDC is suggesting, of course, that we continue these mask mandates. So states seem to be going off on their own here, and maybe in the next couple of months, we're going to find ourselves in a world where this is micro-local, not just state governments, but county and town and city governments making these decisions.
Hey, Joe, let's get to policy quickly. Senator Joe Manchin saying this, quote, "The most important thing we have to deal with is our fiscal responsibilities and a financial position in our country. Joe, that does not sound like a senator who's about to agree to a big spending plan anytime soon.
Well, I think that's true. Look, when that inflation report, when the CPI report came out last week, Jonathan, he issued a statement and went even further to say, we all have a responsibility to do all that is possible to roll back inflation. It's an obsession for him. It has been before. It was for everyone else here in Washington, D.C. And as they consider maybe a smaller, more palatable version of Build Back Better, I would point you to the debate on the budget that's going on right now as we try to play a little bit of small ball here this year after the big comprehensive bills occupied our attention last year. There's an omnibus budget that's being carved out right now. They're debating it right now, and it could be a vehicle for some of the smaller, more popular items, say an expanded child tax credit that never happened under Build Back Better. It's an opportunity here for Democrats, knowing that as we look down the road here and look at the calendar, this is a midterm election year, Jonathan. The longer we wait, the harder it will be for Democrats to pass anything ambitious.
Joe, just quickly, if we got some clarity from Senator Manchin on what he would agree to, what elements of that package that he would vote for.
We know that the pre-K, for instance, a universal pre-K program would be important. We know that certain elements of the climate change provisions in Build Back Better would be important if they don't run across the coal industry in his own state. The fact of the matter is, though, he has shown no appetite for spending, and there's also the matter of Kyrsten Sinema, the senator from Arizona, who's not looking for the tax increases. One of the ideas being reported now, the White House suggesting that they maintain the tax component but have a much smaller price tag, so this becomes a deficit reduction tool. We'll see, Jonathan, if that helps to turn anybody around.
Joe, thank you, sir. Joe Matthew. Down in D.C., we appreciate it, as always. Just to pick up on what's happening in this bond market, on Thursday, we had this massive move of more than 20 basis points, briefly breached 160, higher to session 163.58. Then on Friday, it carried through until the latter half of the session where we started to worry about Ukraine, Russia, and all things associated with it. Yields gapped lower, break of 150 at the close on Friday. Continued that story for a brief moment this Monday, and then we got that line out of Russia. That line out of Russia from the Russian president, who just said all right to a proposal by the foreign minister, Sergei Lavrov, to leave the door open to more conversations around the diplomatic route. And that just unlocked higher yields again. Bang, up 10 basis points and back through 160 at the front end on twos. That's what I've got my eye on through the morning. We'll be looking at the sector price action now in this equity market about 22 minutes in. We can do that with Kriti Gupta. Hey, Kriti.
Well, good morning, John. You are seeing a little bit of pressure in the broader index, the S&P 500, just dipping into the red here. But there is some green on the screen underneath the hood. A lot of that has to come from that tech space. You were just mentioning those yields. Well, think about it. Yields and tech now have that positive correlation, a little bit of that defensive tilt coming back into the market. Once again, tech also serving as that inflation hedge. Toward the bottom, though, you do have energy, consumer staples, healthcare, a lot of the sectors that were actually in the green last week, well, they are down this Monday morning. Somewhere in the middle, you have industrials, which really holds a lot of your defense names. This is a sector you want to keep an eye on. As we talk about geopolitical risk, Lockheed Martin, Boeing, these are the names that are going to catch a little bit of a hit. Lockheed Martin actually having some news of its own this morning, ending its bid to buy Aerojet Rocketdyne after the FTC sued to block the $4.4 billion deal on competition concerns. So once again, aerospace, industrials, that's the sector you want to watch, John.
Kriti, thank you very much. Your equity market just about positive then on the S&P. Kriti breaking down the sector price action for you on the NASDAQ, up 0.6%. That was not the story just a few hours ago. Up next, your trading diary. Busy week still ahead from New York. This is Bloomberg.
The capital markets can really help the shift to sustainable and decarbonized global economy. What are you noticing in that as ESG is now the buzzword literally everywhere?
It is definitely the topic of conversation in most meetings I've had. I have with company CEOs, with investors, with industry groups. It's amazing.
From New York City.
Here in London.
In Sydney.
In San Francisco.
9 a.m. in Beijing and Shanghai.
Good morning, everyone.
Have a great evening.
To recap the headlines.
You do not want to miss this
How
story.
How are you thinking about those dynamics?
I have to say, given the negative momentum out of Friday into Monday and over the weekend, up 0.03% feels like a big update right now. Just a few hours ago, deeply negative. Then we turned around off the back of those comments from the Russian President Vladimir Putin in response to his foreign minister about a proposal to continue those talks on the foreign policy effort, just to keep things diplomatic for now. Equities up by about 0.9% on a Russell, on the Nasdaq up 0.6%, on a two-year yield up a whole lot more from where we were earlier this morning, that's for sure. Breaker 160 again, up 10 basis points, a lift of 5 basis points on 10s, and that curve, the spread between 2s and 10s, flatter, compresses even more. That's the price action. Here's your trading diary, what to look for. President Lagarde addressing Parliament, 11:15 Eastern. Host of economic data through the week, PPI on Tuesday, retail sales and Fed minutes on Wednesday. Jobless claims on Thursday and a busy slate of Fed speak throughout the week. Mester, Evans, Williams, Kashkari, all on the docket. From New York City, for our audience worldwide, thank you for choosing Bloomberg TV. This was the Countdown to the Open. This is Bloomberg.
What do you think is the impact of the Prime Minister on the market?
As Mr. Suzuki, who is the Financial Services Minister, he mentioned at the, his own press conference, and share buybacks is widely used to return profits to shareholders and improve ROE. And how to share out the profits from growth is, you know, totally the decision of the management of each company after carefully taking, you know, all the stakeholders into consideration. And I believe Mr. Kishida has a quite cautious stance on the uniform regulation of share buybacks. And I think because he is giving a consideration to each company's, you know, individual circumstance and decisions.
Bloomberg has enhanced search on the terminal to deliver what you need when you need it. Now, you can simply type phrases in everyday English in the command line. Compare financials. Find people. Analyze markets. You can enter phrases or ask questions. What do you want to know today? Ask a question or visit Search Go to find answers now.
Thank you.
Sea's Number Fever campaign in the Philippines has probably gone down in history as one of the biggest marketing disasters in history, mainly because of a human error that led Pepsi to print more winning caps than they planned. The resulting chaos caused riots, civil unrest, and even deaths. Reporting this story took over a year, and it resulted in me flying to Manila in the Philippines to meet unlucky winners and to find out exactly what happened back then in the 1990s. My name is Jeff Maish. I'm a journalist based in Los Angeles. I wrote the story for Bloomberg Businessweek about Pepsi's Number Fever campaign. The Philippines is a really interesting country. It's made up of thousands of islands. And it's also a country that's very heavily influenced by America. American culture is everywhere you look in the Philippines. They're obsessed with Frank Sinatra music, for example. They love all things America, and that extends to their love for soft drinks, Pepsi Cola, Coca-Cola. In the 1990s, it was everywhere. Pepsi and Coca-Cola were embroiled in what is now known as the Cola Wars. It was a fierce battle for market dominance. Number Fever was already a really popular promotion. It had been rolled out in America to great success. And so Pepsi decided to roll it out internationally, particularly in Asia. They thought it was the answer to their problems. They thought it could finally help them beat their biggest competitor.
898, I won! Look for the winning number in Sari-Sari stores every day, also on TV, radio, newspapers. Could be a millionaire.
A million pesos, or $68,000, doesn't sound like a lot now. But in 1992, that was a phenomenal amount of money. You've got to remember that in the Philippines at the time, the average monthly income was about $100. So a million pesos was wealth beyond anyone's wildest imaginations. Number Fever caught fire in the Philippines. Kids were saving up their pocket money to buy a bottle of Pepsi. Parents were squirreling away all of the bottle caps in bags. You would walk down the street and people were going through trash trying to find discarded bottle caps. It was a national phenomenon. Pepsi boasted that half the population of the Philippines was playing it. Number Fever boosted Pepsi's sales every month from $10 million to $14 million. It had a huge impact on Pepsi's bottom line. Number Fever quickly became Number Hysteria. Maids were being jailed for stealing their employers' winning bottle caps. There was even some murders over winning bottle caps. People were fighting in the streets over these caps. There were signs that there were going to be problems with Number Fever very early. Pepsi had rolled out the competition in Chile, and a garbled fax had caused some kind of problem with the winning number. They'd announced the wrong one in Chile, causing riots. There were signs that there could be big problems ahead if they didn't keep their eye on the ball. So in 1992, Pepsi decided to extend the campaign in the Philippines, and they announced that the competition would go on for a few more weeks. One night, on the television news, they announced the latest winning number, 349. The problem was, 349 had already been allocated as a non-winning number in earlier campaigns. So there were literally hundreds of thousands of bottle caps with 349 just floating around the Philippines. Hundreds of thousands of people all across the Philippines, thousands of islands, were finding winning bottle caps. 349, 349. Some people had 10 lucky 349 bottle caps. People were dancing in the street, celebrating. They thought their problems were over. They were millionaires. It's still not certain exactly how many winners there were of lucky 349 bottle caps, but we know that Pepsi printed over 600,000 of them. Pepsi realized very early that there was a problem. Hundreds of people started arriving at their bottling plants with their lucky bottle caps. They realized something was seriously wrong. Pepsi tried to solve the problem by offering a small token donation to anyone that brought a lucky bottle cap to their bottling plant. But it wasn't enough. People didn't want just a handful of pesos. People wanted their million peso prize. Within a year, violent protests and riots outside Pepsi factories would leave dozens injured and five people dead. At one Pepsi factory in the Philippines, a grenade was thrown through the window. It killed three Pepsi employees. Anacita Rosario was a school teacher living near Manila in the Philippines. She was one of the tragic victims of this whole thing. She was walking to a nearby store to buy some rice one day when a Molotov cocktail was thrown at a Pepsi truck in a violent protest. It bounced under the truck and exploded. It killed her and an innocent bystander who was just a child and injured many others. When I was in the Philippines, I tracked down Anacita's daughter, Cindy, and her husband, Raul. It was clear to me that they were still very upset by the whole thing. You know, a family had been ripped apart by this competition. And Raul told me that he'd never remarried. He'd told me that he'd gone to meet Pepsi executives after his wife was killed. And he was angry. He said to them, you know, this wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for you, if it wasn't for Number Fever. The biggest revelation from my reporting was rumors that Pepsi was somehow involved in bombing their own trucks. I found a newspaper report with a headline that said, Pepsi goons bomb their own trucks. And when I visited the MBI, the police department in the Philippines, they presented me with documents and interviews with people who claimed that Pepsi had paid them to cause riots and to cause trouble outside their plants in order to destabilize the situation and to frame the owners of the coalitions that were fighting them to try and curry favor. I just thought that was so shocking. And of course, Pepsi denied it, but how bizarre that a company would be accused of bombing their own trucks. The contest had sparked so much anger in the Philippines because it landed at just this really weird time in the Philippines history. It was during a crazy election that was racked with allegations of fraud. The Philippines was in a kind of love-hate relationship with America. They loved, obviously, the American aid and finances that was pouring into the country, but at the same time, they yearned for independence. They wanted to be their own country. Vicente Del Fierro was a local preacher living in Manila, and he hated the Number Fever campaign. Del Fierro thought Pepsi's Number Fever campaign was just one of the many ways that America was asserting its dominance over a third world country. He hated seeing his fellow countrymen get ripped off, in his eyes, by this huge multinational American company. He wanted justice. Del Fierro rounded up over 800 winners of 349 bottle caps, and he got them all together to sue Pepsi for over $400 million to be divided between those holders of lucky bottle caps. Del Fierro took money from some of the people who could afford it. They paid him 500 pesos to help with legal fees, but for people who couldn't afford the money, he would just represent them pro bono.
Alliance, they say, is to build up pressure on Pepsi. And so you see people marching in the streets. Mm-hmm. So we have mounted our own campaign, even in the U.S.
He flew to America and he hired two consumer lawyers here in America to take on Pepsi. He had a meeting at Pepsi's headquarters to try and resolve the problem. But he said he wanted to take it all the way to the highest courts in America. When those cases were heard in America, those courts decided that this was a problem that should be heard in the Philippines, not in America. Back in the Philippines, Del Fierro continued his case in the Filipino courts. At one stage, there were arrest warrants handed out for 9 Pepsi Cola executives, which he saw as a big victory. We don't know if those arrest warrants were ever upheld, but it made newspaper headlines across the country. Pepsi did not take kindly to Del Fierro's campaign. They tried everything to shut him down. They sued him for libel.
My father had to attend 3 times a month for a branch 145 and another hearing for the branch 138, also 3 times a month. Also, there was a time my father was hospital due to heart failure. Still, he had to attend the 2 branch hearing. Otherwise, for not attending, the judge will issue warrant of arrest to my father. My father passed away January 13, 2010, after staying for almost 1 year in the hospital. He died of complication due to heart failure. After the death of my father, I was inspired to do the website. PepsiCo will be remembered for what they did to the consumer in the Philippines and to my father.
When I reached out to Pepsi for comment for this story, they claimed that they didn't have access to anyone who was working at Pepsi that was around in those days. They also said that during COVID-19, they didn't have access to their documents about this. But, you know, they were very careful to say that they were sorry for everything that happened. And we do know that Pepsi did try everything to try and make this right. The Pepsi Number Fever disaster cost the company millions. We know that they paid up to $10 million in those goodwill payments. But the financial effect could be much greater. After the disaster, we know that Pepsi sales dipped. They were overtaken by Coca-Cola again. Pepsi's Number Fever disaster changed the legacy of that soft drink in the Philippines forever. Some people of a certain age won't touch it. For many people, Pepsi is a taboo word. A lot of the people that I spoke to were still quite traumatized by their experience, by that experience of winning ₱1,000,000, losing it, and then returning to their normal life in poverty in Manila.
When the news of the bombing came out, it was a massive story in Germany.
We are following some breaking news coming to us out of Dortmund in Germany.
It was covered by all the media outlets.
3 roadside explosions triggered at the same time last night as a coach left its hotel in the south of Dortmund.
Public figures commented on it.
We should not let them affect our life, whoever it was.
The media echo went far beyond Dortmund.
I think it was front page news in every single big paper around Europe. Everyone thought of like a terrorist attack, and people were scared that throughout the city in Dortmund there was more attacks to be happening.
Unbeknownst to investigators, just after the bomb went off and the players of the team were shell-shocked, the person who had masterminded the attack was actually sitting in the hotel eating steak and sweet potatoes. My name is Thomas Rogers. I'm the journalist who wrote the article, The Get Rich Quick Scheme That Nearly Killed a German Soccer Team. Dortmund is a mid-sized city in the western part of Germany in a state called North Rhine-Westphalia. And it's a former industrial city that's kind of fallen on hard times in the last few decades. It was severely bombed in the war. So the center of the city is quite stark. Some of the few high points include its soccer team.
My name is Ike Henning. I'm a reporter with Bloomberg News, and I'm a great fan of Borussia Dortmund. Dortmund fans are super loyal. On all match days, the entire city is in black and yellow. It's like a religion.
I think more than most German cities, soccer does play a very large role in the identity of Dortmund. In October of 2000, the BVB became the first team in the Bundesliga to actually go public. Salaries for soccer players in the Bundesliga have gone up very dramatically. With such high prices, they thought that by going public, they would be able to compete better with big teams like Bayern Munich.
Unfortunately, that didn't go too well. Dortmund bought too many expensive players, high wages, and the club almost went bust in 2005.
The price of their shares, it has sometimes gone up, but mostly gone down since they made that decision. So on April 11th, 2017, the team was staying in a hotel on the outskirts of Dortmund.
Match days are always special in Dortmund. Everyone is looking forward to it. The team always meets in the same hotel ahead of matches.
They stayed in this hotel in order to have a kind of neutral space before games so that they could concentrate, be sort of isolated from distractions, things like that.
Everyone was pretty optimistic. They had a chance to go really far, maybe into the finals. I was in the office and getting ready for match day. I was going to meet with a friend, a fellow Dortmund supporter in a pub. As always, the fans are very excited about matches.
On that day, we're heading to play in the quarterfinal against AS Monaco at Signal Iduna Stadium, which is in the center of Dortmund. Shortly before 7 p.m., the players of the team boarded their official team bus.
When the bus took off the parking lot of the hotel and turned on the street, there were three detonations, three bombs that exploded and hit the bus of Dortmund.
Three explosions occurred close to the Borussia Dortmund team bus. The B-team bus had just left the hotel. The explosions destroyed two windows in the rear part of the bus.
People screamed, people jumped to the ground.
The fellow Dortmund fan I was supposed to watch the match with, he called me and said, turn on the TV, there was an attack on the Dortmund bus. And I thought he was like, that was impossible.
Some of the players screamed at the driver to keep driving as fast as possible because they were worried that people might storm the bus.
German investigators say the explosive devices used in the attack on the Borussia Dortmund bus contained metal pins and that one had pierced a seat headrest.
Unbeknownst to the team members, the actual mastermind behind the attack was, as they were disembarking, the bus was actually eating steak and sweet potatoes at the hotel they had just left.
Authorities are attempting to verify a letter left at the scene claiming jihadists were behind the attack.
Because there had been a series of attacks by Islamic terrorists in Germany and Europe, there was widespread suspicion in the media that this was another Islamic terror attack. Three letters were found at the site of the bombing that took credit for the attack on behalf of Islamic State. There were, however, reasons to doubt this particular narrative.
Would actually be a surprise if ISIS were actually part of this attack. Possibly could be a ploy by other groups like the far right wing to try and shift the blame.
The letters had some strange qualities. They were written in a strange German that used big, sophisticated words, but had basic grammar mistakes, as if someone was native German speaker, but pretending to be a foreign person.
Federal investigators have detained one man suspected of links to Islamist terrorism, one of two suspects whose apartments were raided this morning.
Shortly after the bombing, a man in Austria named Rudolf, who was a big BVB fan, he noticed that something strange was going on the stock market related to the team's shares. He emailed the lawyers of BVB, who then forwarded that email on to investigators. The email stated that someone had bought 60,000 BVB put options, a wager that the value of the shares of the team would fall below a certain amount at a certain date.
Why would someone buy that ahead of a match and then three bombs go off? Something isn't right here.
For the person to make money off of that, it required the stock to go down quite a bit in a fairly short period of time. And it wouldn't just be the team losing a match, it would require something much bigger than that. There was another big red flag about this purchase, which is the fact that it had actually been made, number one, on the day of the bombing, but also from an IP address that had been traced to the actual hotel where the bombing had taken place.
When three explosions targeted the bus carrying the Borussia Dortmund footballers on April the 11th, written notes left at the scene claimed the attack was the work of ISIL. The truth, as is now alleged, is remarkable.
On April 21st, the police arrested a man in a southern German city called Tübingen. He was on his way to work, and his name was Sergei Wienergold. He seemed like an unlikely suspect because he had no known connections to the Islamic terror world. He didn't seem like a far-right extremist. He didn't seem like a left-wing extremist either. He seemed to be a completely unremarkable young man.
A 28-year-old German-Russian man named only as Sergei W. stayed in the same hotel as the players on the night before the bombing. He specifically requested an upper room overlooking the bushes where the explosive devices were hidden.
The media dissected why he would do that, what was his past.
He had been inspired by the 2015 terror attack in Paris. And he noticed that in the aftermath of the attack, the stocks of French companies went down. And he believed that if an attack took place that was directed at a specific company, that the decrease in stock price for that company would be even more dramatic.
It never occurred to anyone that someone would do that out of greed.
We now know that the suspect bought three different derivatives on the Borussia Dortmund shares. With all these derivatives, he bet on falling shares. The suspect bought the majority of these financial products on the 11th of April, the day of the attack.
If the plot had been completely successful and the stock had reached a value of zero, Wienergold would have made up to 570,000 euros, or the equivalent of about $608,000. Ultimately, the plan completely backfired.
The attacker, Sergei Wienergold, didn't make any money. In fact, he lost money.
In court, he would be extremely quiet. He usually kept his hands clasped together. One of the lawyers actually commented that he had never seen a defendant act so calmly. Wienergold had served some time in the German military. From that information and from online research, he was able to figure out how to assemble remote detonated bombs that would do what he hoped to do. There were a few days of extremely emotional testimony, including the soccer players who described doubting whether or not they could ever play another game again.
It brought everything back up, and it didn't quite help them to kind of process what was going on.
Throughout it all, he sat there completely silent. The big mystery that was swirling around the trial was the question of why he may have simply done it because he wanted to impress a woman. Rebecca is a young woman who has a very troubled home life. She ultimately sees her relationship with Wienergold as an opportunity to leave that troubled home. Wienergold is a Russian immigrant to Germany. He speaks with an accent. He has anxiety in large groups of Germans. She begins to resent the fact that he has these fears and feels a little bit trapped. Rebecca attempts to dump him on multiple occasions, and he threatens to commit suicide if she leaves him. Wienergold apparently told Rebecca that she would soon be seeing a surprise. After being dumped, via text message. He apparently began planning for this attack in earnest. Intergold was charged with 28 counts of attempted murder, which carried a maximum sentence in Germany of life in prison. He claimed that he had nothing to do with the attack, but as time went on, he admitted that he had actually been the person who had built the explosives and had set them off. But he claimed that he didn't want to actually kill anybody. Ultimately, Vaynergold didn't receive the harshest possible sentence. He was given 14 years in prison, but it's...
Yeah, feeling lucky. You told me you love me. And I was in a hurry. It was 7:30. A little too early. Couldn't comprehend. Swear to God, you drive me crazy. I'm going bad. I'm going back. I'm going there. Push me to the edge, but I'm going there. Getting drunk.
The threat of an asteroid hitting Earth is very real. If it's big enough, it's also very final.
These are very, very infrequent events. The probability is not zero, though.
A blinding flash of light streaking across the sky.
About 100 tons of space rock falls on Earth every day. Most of it is so small it burns up in our atmosphere or lands unnoticed away from major populations. No human in the past 1,000 years is known to have been killed by a meteorite. And according to NASA, no large object is likely to strike the Earth any time in the next several hundred years. However, one thing is certain. We haven't found them all.
There are thousands out there, and we don't know where they are.
There are a lot of asteroids in our solar system. They number in the billions.
Scientists all over the world are working toward detecting and deflecting the most catastrophic of natural disasters.
The race is on to find as many of these objects as we can.
We have a way of calculating whether or not an asteroid is potentially dangerous or not.
I mean, I think it's something worth investing in. It's our existence at stake, right?
Amy, let's get this one out of the way. It's probably the question you get asked the most, but how scared should we be?
Asteroids and comets are a natural hazard that's out there like a lot of other natural hazards. These are very, very infrequent events, these collision events where an object actually impacts the Earth. The most important thing that we need to know about asteroids is, you know, when the next impact is going to happen and how bad it will be. What we know is that an object that's about, say, a kilometer across is capable of causing very, very wide devastation across the planet, really, truly global devastation. The object that wiped out the dinosaurs was somewhere in the neighborhood of 5 to 10 kilometers across, so even bigger than that. At a kilometer, it's still going to be very bad and it will have global effects. For objects that are capable of causing what I would call sort of regional damage, kind of a large major metropolitan area, a city and its surrounding environments, sort of around 100-ish meters. It depends on the details of the composition and so forth.
By the 1980s, NASA was cataloging near-Earth objects. In 1994, stargazers watched as comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 hit Jupiter. The resulting zone of chaos was estimated to be as large as the Earth, and the event became a turning point in the search for asteroids and comets in our solar system. In 1998, Congress tasked NASA with finding 90% of asteroids and comets 1 kilometer wide or larger. Soon after, Hollywood blockbusters Armageddon and Deep Impact brought attention and fear to the masses.
The great news is that the vast majority, more than 90% of all the really large 1 kilometer near-Earth objects have been found. The challenge now is working down to these smaller sizes that are still quite capable of causing a lot of damage, but they're just harder to spot because they're fainter, they're smaller.
Can you give us a sense of how many are out there in our solar system?
We know that there are a lot of asteroids in our solar system. They number in the billions. Most of them, however, are between Mars and Jupiter in what we call the main asteroid belt. This is a region of space where most of the asteroids in the inner part of our solar system live, and they stay there for many billions of years. There is another population, though, that kind of leaks inward and gets into the region somewhat close to the Earth, and we call these near-Earth objects. We think that there are millions and millions of near-Earth objects that are out there in the total population. As of today, we know of sort of around 20, 25,000, something like that. When we first spot an object, we really know very little about it. We just see something moving across the sky. So all you get is just sort of a handful of snapshots, just enough to be able to tell that this isn't an asteroid that we've already seen before. And then once we can calculate the distance to it, we can now start to make predictions about its true size. Is it large or is it small? So we have a lot of information that we have to get pretty quickly to really understand what's going on.
Finding asteroids is just one piece of the puzzle. Planetary scientists are extremely skilled in determining the orbits and speeds of asteroids based on relatively small amounts of data. NASA runs simulations of the trajectories asteroids could take, which is useful but time-consuming. A team of scientists in the Netherlands have found a way that could buy us more time.
Our method is very quick. So you can very quickly get an assessment of whether or not the object is dangerous or not. If you look at the classical way of determining the danger of an asteroid, it may take, you know, days of computing time on very big machines to determine this hazardousness.
The current problem is that there's just too many asteroids out there to spend a huge amount of computational power on all of them. So the neural network allows us to focus on what really could go and pose a hazard to Earth.
A neural network is a computing system that mimics the way the human brain operates to find underlying relationships in a set of data.
By training the network in this way, you train it in recognizing those objects that are most likely to hit the planet. And once it's trained, you can apply this network to all the unknown asteroids. And then you can make a selection and saying, hey, these are the ones which appear to be having orbits similar to the ones which we know are hitting the planet. That doesn't mean that they do, but it only means that they look very similar to the ones we know they do.
What else did you find? Should we be particularly concerned about anything?
One thing that we did find is that our neural network was able to go and identify a handful of asteroids which weren't considered potentially hazardous, that when we went and integrated them forward in time, they came quite close to Earth.
We find a handful which were not detected before or not considered being dangerous before, and we think they are potentially dangerous.
It's very hard to simulate kind of going forward in time an asteroid that's going to hit Earth because, well, the Earth is really small. And space is really big. And then you have to have very exact parameters to shoot an asteroid that goes and hits exactly Earth. And then Simon had the ingenious idea of not even trying to do that and just launching the asteroids from Earth's surface and integrating backwards in time.
It's very hard to make it hit. So you need a lot of calculations, which all end up in nothing. And the idea was then like, well, let's not do that. This is basically what NASA is doing. NASA is taking an asteroid, making multiple copies of them, shooting them all forwards in time, calculating their orbits, and then see what fraction sort of gets close to Earth. Not even hitting Earth, but getting close to Earth. And that they call it a potential impactor. So you calculate the solar system forwards in time for, let's say, 1,000 years. And then you launch asteroids from the surface as if they, if you go forwards in time, would fall on the surface. You calculate them backwards to today, and then you get your orbital parameters of today's asteroids, which you know will land on the planet. And those you can use as known impactors and compare with all the other asteroids in the solar system.
Can simulations and AI, can those things fill in the gaps where perhaps telescopes and other imaging tools can't?
Absolutely, since the observations get more complex. The physics gets more complex, and if the physics get more complex, the mathematics becomes more complex, and at some point you can't solve your problems analytically anymore, and then this is where the computer comes in. Now we have this trained neural network, we have a way of calculating in a fraction of a second whether or not an asteroid is potentially dangerous or not, and therefore deserves more attention or more time to spend on for really finding out if it is dangerous.
When it comes to hunting asteroids, time is critical.
What we can do about a potentially hazardous object depends a great deal on what we know about it and how much time we have before the encounter. We'd really like to find them when they're decades away. Because the more time you have, the more options you have, and the less energy it takes to move an object aside.
It also means we might not have to resort to launching a nuclear warhead at an asteroid. Until recently, pretty much our only choice.
That's an option of last resort, in my opinion, yes. We have lots of options available. You can just simply bump into the object and just nudge it out of the way. That's one possibility, and that's kind of, in a way, sort of the simplest thing to think about, just nudging it off its path a little bit with, you know, a massive object, a spacecraft, let's say. It's just kind of like bowling, if you will. You know, if you have a long time or a long stretch of runway in the lane, just a very small twist on the bowling ball will make a big change in where it ultimately ends up. Another option, it would be something where you take a very big, big, massive spacecraft and you park it next to the object and you use the force of gravity as a towing rig. That takes longer, though, and you need to be able to send a pretty massive spacecraft, and it obviously depends a lot on how big the asteroid is. Other options start to get more and more complicated, and they range from painting one side of the object a white color and painting the other side dark and then letting the pressure of light sort of perturb its orbit.
In a departure from the lab and computer simulations, NASA has real plans to rehearse kinetic impact deflection. In 2021, the agency will launch DART, the Double Asteroid Redirection Test mission, which will intercept a 160-meter asteroid in 2022. Better to practice now before we have to deal with an actual threat. In the meantime, discovering asteroids is our best bet. Thousands of scientists and amateur astronomers around the world make up an informal network that survey the heavens. But that may not be enough. NASA wants more resources to map our solar system and better technology.
We need to ramp up our network of sensors, and also we need to just continue to strengthen our network of international observers so that we can get follow-up, because we find these objects when they're distributed all over the night sky.
Once we get more observations, we get better data, we can make better predictions.
If you look at the big impactors we have had in the last, let's say, 20 years or maybe 30 years, 50 years, most of them we haven't seen coming. So the danger, the real danger, I think, comes from the objects we don't know about and not from the objects we do know about.
This particular natural disaster, like a lot of natural disasters and like climate change, is a problem of the global commons. So the thing that we risk collectively is that it sort of then becomes nobody's problem and nobody takes ownership over it. The asteroids are all over the sky. They just truly cross boundaries and borders with a second's notice.
I kind of imagine in the future, maybe lots of small satellites around the Earth that are always going and looking outward. I mean, I think it's something worth investing in. It's our existence at stake, right?
The pandemic has affected everyone in different ways. Some pass the time by baking.
Homemade sourdough bread. Do I need to say more?
Some chose to binge watch Netflix.
It's your game.
Or maybe you started a garden oasis in your backyard.
Next, I'm going to put my lettuces in.
But for millions of others,
I'm going to be posting stocks that will boom.
they wanted to uproot the financial industry.
Let's just lock it on up and take $15,000!
Here's a stock that can change your life.
I see a stock going up and I buy it, and I just watch it until it stops going up, and then I sell it.
I have gained over $3 million.
I want some free money.
I don't think you can overstate the online communities or social media's influence on financial markets.
A large group of inexperienced investors who discuss their plans on social media platform Reddit have shaken up the stock market in a big way.
The stock that everybody's talking about right now is GameStop.
Video game retailer GameStop is set to continue their head-spinning ascent today.
The revolutionaries on Reddit are spanking Wall Street's ass.
The more these stocks go up, the more the big guys are getting creamed and losing billions of dollars.
This isn't a wealthy person's game anymore. Anyone can play it.
I took up a little bit of a new hobby, and I am interested in day trading.
As an investor nowadays, you don't have to look a specific way. You don't have to wear specific clothes. You don't have to be doing it from a trading floor on Wall Street in like a high-rise building in downtown Manhattan.
The narrative of what's driving the markets is no longer being held in secret offices in New York and Boston of privileged people talking to other privileged people. It's right out in the open. It's on Twitter, it's on Reddit.
From brokerage apps to Discord channels and subreddits to TikTok finfluencers, one of the last holdouts in the world of disruption, finance, is next in line.
Investing should be as ubiquitous as shopping online.
That's Vlad Tenev, the CEO of Robinhood, the online brokerage app, talking about how he wants his app to disrupt the world of stock trading like Amazon disrupted the world of home shopping.
And I think that speaks to exactly the mission that a platform like Robinhood has, which is to democratize investing.
Robinhood was started in 2013 by Vlad Tenev and Baiju Bhatt in, where else, Silicon Valley, as an alternative to the big brokerages, but with one big difference.
As they were building the social network around finances for people, they realized that there was a gap in the market and that free trading could become something that they could bring to the markets, they could disrupt the industry.
While no-fee trading is industry standard today, it was unheard of when it was first introduced.
The online brokerage industry was really innovative when they came on the scene 10, 15 years ago, but they kind of stopped innovating, where you haven't seen those commissions come down beyond $5 or $6 or $7. Robinhood think that by offering zero commission, that they're going to push people onto this platform.
And on top of no-fee trading, the customers Robinhood was courting have been long overlooked in the world of finance.
So the typical customer of a Charles Schwab, for example, is putting a lot more money in that brokerage account than the typical customer at Robinhood. Even today, with all of its popularity, the median account size is about $240.
There's Fidelities in the Schwabs and the E-Trades of the world. They look down their nose at those kind of accounts. I don't want a $1,000 account. They're just a headache. I want a $100,000 account.
And this is key here, right? Because the thing about Robinhood that's different than every other single brokerage platform is how easy it is to use.
The design of the Robinhood app really has in mind a user who might be coming at this absolutely cold.
The fonts are very well sized, the shapes, the colors, all of that is something that the founders of Robinhood paid really close attention to.
And by creating an interface that catered to a newer investor, they were able to gather a pretty healthy group of customers. And by 2019, they had about 10 million customers.
Those 10 million customers were a huge success story for Robinhood, but no one could have predicted its explosion after the arrival of COVID-19.
Remain indoors to the greatest extent, and 100% of the non-essential workforce must stay home.
What we saw when the pandemic hit was the growth of Robinhood users absolutely turbocharged. And oddly, you saw this surge in interest in stock trading. Then they saw the absolute surge in 2020 in customer growth. And now, by many accounts, they have more than 20 million customers, which is pretty extraordinary. Small account sizes to get them to grow with the company, and as it releases more products, come along with them.
Robinhood would become one of the COVID economy's breakout successes. Robinhood traders, as they're called, became the shorthand explanation for the frenzy of often speculative retail investing after the pandemic lockdowns.
Kids wake up in the morning, they go on Robinhood. They're, you know, in the shower, they check Robinhood. Kids are learning how the stock market works at 18 while they're at school, you know, checking their phones in between classes because notifications pop up telling them what their stocks are doing that day.
With these new tools, millennials and Gen Z are investing in the market in ways their parents could have never even dreamt of.
That is sort of key when we talk about the divide between older and younger generations, is that the younger generation is exposed to so much more information and tools at their disposal to do what they want in the market.
The older generations, you never had the technology or the cost structure that you could play the markets like you can today. So you were stuck with giving your money to a professional investor and paying them a fee to do it.
When I speak to young kids, they tell me, I'm making mistakes, I'm losing money, I'm not a perfect investor, but I'm 18, and by the time I'm 30, which will be, you know, 10 years from now, I'm gonna have interacted with the markets for a decade. And so it's a learning experience more so than anything else.
And you can look at it and you can say, wow, that's, you know, that's risk-taking, that's dumb, but, you know, if you could possibly shave 10, 20 years off your working life versus adding 5 years, I don't think you can fault people for that.
But Robinhood is only part of the puzzle. Sure, you can trade on it, but without research, information, and data, you're just blindly throwing darts at different stocks and hoping to strike it rich.
Wall Street forever has always run on what we now call narratives or memes. You know, people telling rumors to each other have been around for 100 years.
On Wall Street, information is its own currency. Historically, either you had it or you didn't. And the people who had it had a huge advantage.
In the past, those narratives and memes didn't have a network effect. It would be one person telling another person over the phone. In fact, when I broke into this business in the 80s, a lot of people used to complain that they weren't on the call list to get those ideas.
Social media changed all of that.
Fast forward to 2021, that's being done on the internet now, and that's being done on Discord and Twitter and StockTwits and Reddit. And the impact is very similar, but orders and orders of magnitude larger.
As social media has played a bigger part in our lives, it's also played a bigger and kind of more important role in how people find investing ideas online and on these platforms.
How do those ideas spread? On TikTok. Yes, that TikTok.
Soon may the weatherman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum.
People aren't just going to it for sea shanty videos.
The personal finance hashtag on TikTok has garnered 3.5 billion views from its 1 billion monthly active users. By comparison, videos found under the cooking and health tips hashtag have 2.6 and 2.1 billion views, respectively.
The trajectory of Robinhood and TikTok were literally on par.
What happened in the stock market this week? So the word of the week is expectations.
Absolutely essential that you guys understand the risks of shorting.
And Kayla Kilbride and Kyla Scanlon are two of those financial influencer TikTokers, also known as Finfluencers.
I think people still care about fashion, they care about culture, but it's also like there's this big behemoth thing
called the stock market that we really don't know a whole lot about, and it's gatekept behind the industry. And so people like want to unpack that. And so my audience is, a lot of them are younger investors who are looking to hone their skills.
Tech and write-up.
Kyla and Kayla are two of the more, let's say, professional TikTok influencers.
The Tesla ARK Bitcoin Biotech Risk Cluster.
I've been trading since high school, and it was a really interesting way for me to fill out my decision-making frameworks and to think about thinking. And I think that the more that we can have people thinking about finance, the better that we're going to progress as a society. I think it's a huge gap in our educational system.
If you're going to buy an option for a stock you think is going to go up, it's a call. So think of it like this.
I made the options video where I was like, options are just like shopping.
Rumor has it that this pal is about to go up in price. So if I come in tomorrow, can I still buy it at said price?
And a ton of women just like attacked that video and were like, you explain things so much better than my boyfriend or my professor, or like, I could sit and listen to you all day. And I was like, this is what I was looking for.
But TikTok's algorithm does not reward calm and measured videos about responsible investing. It rewards this.
Watch this video for 30 seconds and you'll be rich for the rest of your life.
I try not to say the A word, the A-L-G-O word, because TikTok listens to us.
The algorithm does impact how you feel. You know, you do notice which videos do better versus which videos do worse.
How do you catch someone's attention in less than 60 seconds? And how do you make it something that they're like, I need this in my life? Nearly impossible to do that in 60 seconds, but the people who perfect it are the people that you're going to watch and going to stick around.
And where people are sticking around, Reddit, and its nearly countless subreddits about finance. And by far the biggest one of those is Wall Street Bets.
There's a lot of social media platforms out there, but Reddit is like the social media platform for finance. Places like Wall Street Bets is where it all goes down.
Started in January 2012, it wasn't long before Wall Street Bets adopted a 4chan-like etiquette, leading to their tagline, like 4chan found a Bloomberg terminal.
We had all these unexplained stock moves, and we would be grasping for why stock XYZ jumped 20% in a day. And you would look at Wall Street Bets, and you would see people there talking about buying options in that stock, and it sort of, you know, squared the circle, so to speak, and started making sense. And it was at that point that it was like, wow, we have to start paying attention to this.
Some people on the platform really spend tons of time, and others are just looking for entertainment and to have a little bit of fun, effectively gambling or looking for an outlet, trying to make a little bit of money.
Then on top of all of that, there were stimulus checks. Now clearly this money is going to people who need to use that to eat, to live, but there's a lot of people who use this money to invest in the stock market.
And it's not just stock tips. People quote unquote YOLO their entire life savings or stimulus checks on a single stock. They post what is called gain and loss porn, screen grabbing staggering hits and misses on stocks for the entire community to see.
I'm about to lose everything.
And while some of the people on Wall Street Bets are novice investors, the community contains multitudes.
In one respect, what it did show us among these network groups is they are very sophisticated. They're not a bunch of ignorant people talking to other ignorant people.
And this is where the pieces of the puzzle all come together to wreak havoc on Wall Street for a solid week in early 2021.
It's pretty clear that the combination of more people having retail brokerage accounts and trading apps and more people being stuck at home looking for some kind of entertainment and some kind of community online came together in this very singular way.
What came together is GameStop.
Let's go back to the beginnings of what happened with GameStop a couple of years ago. On the boards like Reddit and StockTwits, a lot of people were talking about GameStop as being attractive value.
Some of them are even, you know, Wall Street alums who left the industry and now still have access to tools that they can use to improve their financial well-being and make very good decisions. And I think Roaring Kitty is a perfect example of that.
GameStop is one of the most compelling asymmetric opportunities in the market today. Really, I don't understand how you could disagree with that.
At the same time that this crowd was talking it up, The hedge fund institutional crowd didn't like this stock at all, and it had the largest short interest of any stock in the New York Stock Exchange going into late 2020.
Short selling is a bet that a stock price will fall, and it's a fairly simple concept. An investor borrows a stock and then sells it. The investor is betting on buying the stock back later for a lower price before returning it to the original owner, pocketing the price difference.
What a short seller would tell you is that they almost act as a policeman in financial markets, or they're at least looking for companies that aren't what they say they are. And that can range anywhere from an outright fraud that some short sellers try to expose to just a company that's not worth as much as investors think it is.
The problem is, if the stock price rises, the short seller has to come up with the money to buy the stock back. And the more it rises, the more it costs. And that's what's called a short squeeze. And the hedge fund Melvin Capital was on the wrong end of that squeeze.
Melvin Capital lost over 50% of its money in the month of January alone, just from being caught in the short squeeze of the stock.
This is where the disruption comes in.
One of the most wild stories you're ever going to see. GameStop shares absolutely going nuts.
In less than a year, the company's stock has jumped from less than $3 a share to almost $350.
Cheers, everybody!
Roaring Kitty has turned $50,000 or so investment into some $14 million.
Whoa!
Investors all over social media use the free trading app Robinhood to wreak havoc on Wall Street.
They're actually piling on into some of these stocks to really hurt the professional short sellers.
And they all used Reddit, Twitter, TikTok, and Discord to tell one another to keep buying and, quote, hold the line and not sell GameStop.
People are getting cheerleaded for jumping in, buying at the highs. They're saying, keep going.
And it was working, too, until
Thursday morning, the trading app Robinhood sent out this tweet. In light of current market volatility, we are restricting transactions, including GameStop.
People were really angry.
Robinhood was supposed to allow the regular people to play the same game these big boys are playing. But instead, we were all taken for schmucks and they screwed us.
Shares of GameStop are jumping again now that retail investors are being allowed to buy shares of the stock.
But what we learned is that when people organize online, they have the ability to disrupt the market.
And it was a big sign. The ivory walls of the institution aren't as powerful as maybe the institutions thought them to be. I don't know if pumping up GameStop was the best use of billions of dollars, but I think that as a signal to society, it was pretty interesting and powerful.
The GameStop saga was so impactful that both Vlad Tenev and Roaring Kitty were called in to testify before Congress to clarify each of their roles in the saga.
One thing that's emerged from the congressional hearings is that they're interested in how retail brokerages make money and whether they're keeping the best interests of their customers in mind. But it's pretty fuzzy as far as what they would actually do as a result.
While the frenzy around GameStop eventually subsided, it didn't take long for retail investors to find other areas to invest their money.
Take a look at Bitcoin going bananas over the weekend.
Bitcoin forms a brand new all-time high.
It was after GameStop started to drop that we saw Bitcoin really go up to over 60,000.
How much further does this rally have to run?
It's compelling to say that money shifted from one venue to the other.
While correlation doesn't equal causation, there's a chart out there showing an inverse correlation on meme stocks going down and cryptocurrencies going up.
There's definitely an aspect where people are making money on stocks and then moving. You know, they're agnostic. They're not hedge funds. They can invest wherever the hell they want. It's a classic sort of momentum trade. They're going to wherever the winners are and they're willing to jump on and, you know, ride it.
So whether it's meme stocks like GameStop, meme coins like Dogecoin, or entirely new ways to invest in art like NFTs, the new kind of retail investor is making its presence known.
Over the next 10, maybe 15 years, you're going to continue to see, whether by choice or by force, that baton go from older generations to younger generations.
I don't think any single app is going to be a thing.
The Peter Schiff Show.
Today's podcast is sponsored by ExpressVPN. ExpressVPN encrypts 100% of your internet data to keep you safe from hackers and eavesdroppers on your network. Just go to expressvpn.com/gold and you'll get an extra 3 months free on a 1-year subscription package. The podcast is also sponsored by True Niagen. True Niagen helps fuel the cell's energy engines, maintains cellular metabolism, and even supports a healthy heart in combination with a healthy lifestyle. And now you can save 20% on your first purchase at TrueNiagen.com/Peter using the promotional code Peter. These statements have not been evaluated by the Food and Drug Administration. This product is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease. A lot has happened in the 2 days since I recorded my last podcast on Wednesday. All sorts of news came out on Thursday and Friday. Lots of action in various markets. So I'm going to get started with what happened on Friday and work my way backwards to Thursday. First of all, Friday, the markets really got clobbered. The Dow Jones finished the day down just over 500 points. In fact, we had a huge 2-day drop on Thursday and Friday, more than wiping out the gains on the week that had been enjoyed earlier. In fact, over the last 2 days, the Dow Jones is down 2.9%. It's over 1,000 points. It was a 1.43% drop on Friday, but the damage was even worse in the S&P 500. It was down 1.9% yesterday and 3.7% over the prior 2 trading days. Even worse, as you work your way up the risk curve, the NASDAQ dropped 3.15% on Friday alone, extending its 2-day decline to 5.4%. Actually, the Cathie Wood ARK Innovation ETF managed to outperform the NASDAQ on Friday. That's a rare occasion. It only dropped by 2.5%. But over the 2 days, it narrowly edged out the NASDAQ in losses. It dropped 5.5%. over those 2 days. To put all this in context, as far as where we are now, so far in 2022, for the major averages, you have the Dow down 4.4% year to date. You have the S&P 500 down 7.3% year to date. You have the Russell 2000 down 9.5% on the year, and the NASDAQ down 12.8%. solidly in correction territory. You know, that Russell 2000 just on the border of correction territory, though it had a pretty good bounce. In fact, the Russell 2000 is the only index that is still up for the month of February. All of the other indexes are not only down on the year, they are down on the month. Again, look at the Cathie Wood ARK Innovation ETF. That ETF is down 24% so far this year. But in sharp contrast, as I've been saying, not just this year, but at the end of last year, look at the relative performance of value versus growth. People are buying stocks that pay dividends now instead of buying companies that may have earnings in the future. Instead of betting on the come, investors are betting on sure things. Not sure things in that there's no risk, but sure things in that the earnings are already here. The dividends are already here. So you're not buying based on what you hope might happen in the future. You're buying based on what is already happening now. And you have the fact that it's been happening in the past to create some type of assurance that what happened in the past will continue in the future. There's no guarantee, but it's a lot better than hoping that something that's never earned any money and never paid any dividends in the past may eventually start doing it at some distant point in the future. Look at what's going on with the Euro-Pacific funds. And again, if you're going to buy any of my mutual funds, make sure and get a prospectus, read it, and understand all of the risks and make sure they are suitable for you. But in contrast to the carnage on Friday, the Euro-Pacific Dividend Payers Fund rose by 1.3% on the day. And in fact, on the year, that fund is up 6.5%.
But what's more amazing than the fact that the fund is up 6.5% is that it happened at the same time that U.S. markets are getting crushed, particularly the NASDAQ. If you look at the difference between the Euro-Pacific Dividend Payer Fund and the NASDAQ Composite, just this year, the first 6 weeks of 2022, the difference is almost 20%. 19.3% is how much more investors earned by buying dividend-paying foreign stocks versus buying momentum domestic stocks. And you know, the return on the dividend payers fund would have actually been better had I not had an allocation to mining stocks, because gold mining stocks are basically flat on the year. So they're not really adding to the returns. They're subtracting from my returns. I would have an even better return year to date if I had no exposure to gold mining stocks. And if instead I just increase my allocation to the non-gold stocks that are in the portfolio. Now, the reason I have the gold stocks in there is it's because it is my expectation that they will ultimately be among the best performers in the fund and add to the returns. But so far, that has not been the case. In fact, my value fund has a higher allocation to gold stocks than my dividend payers fund. That's why it's only up 5.3% year to date, but it was up a little bit more yesterday than the dividend payers fund, again, because of that exposure to the gold mining sector. And I'll get into what's been going on with gold in a bit. But I want to reiterate another example of this shift in investment strategy, the rotation out of growth into value. One of the best examples in my portfolio is British Tobacco, BTI. And again, when I talk about individual stocks on the podcast, it's not to make a recommendation that anybody run out and buy the stock. I'm just trying to illustrate a point and using this particular stock as an example. It is one of the stocks that we own in our portfolios. The stock was up 4% on Friday. As the market was collapsing, this stock was hitting a new 52-week high, up 4% in one day. That brings the total gain on British Tobacco year to date to 23.5%. We're only 6 weeks into the year, and the rally didn't start this year. It started in December. The stock is now up 37% from its December low. That was about 2 months ago. Now, if you look at the PE, it's still slightly below 11. That means you're buying the stock for less than 11 times its earnings, and the dividend yield is 6.5%. And of course, that's after this big rise, meaning that before we had this 37% rise off the December lows, the PE was lower than it is now. The dividend yield was higher. And in fact, if you compare the current price of British Tobacco to where it was 11 years ago, it's still slightly below where the shares were trading back then. How many things can you buy today at a cheaper price than you could buy it 11 years ago? There's not many. In fact, one of the only ones is gold. The price of gold is also slightly lower than it was in 2011. Again, I'm going to get to gold in a minute, but I want to keep focused on British Tobacco because there is no news. No relevant news has come out on this stock that is responsible for this big rise. So why is it going up? Again, because investors are looking for a place to park the money that they are taking out of momentum stocks and non-dividend paying stocks. And as I've said, they can't go to cash. In the past, people were willing to take refuge in cash. But right now, you can't stay in cash because cash is a very dangerous place to be given how much inflation there is. So you can't just stay in cash. You're losing in cash. Cash is not being on the sidelines. You're still getting beaten up in the game if you're in cash. I mean, maybe cash is not losing as much as momentum stocks, but it's still losing. And if you want to avoid losses, you have to avoid holding cash. Well, what are you going to hold instead of cash? These value stocks, these dividend paying stocks. And if you can buy them at a lower price than what investors were paying to buy the same stocks a decade ago, This is where the money is flowing. And as more and more money flows into these stocks, it attracts additional money to follow those returns. I mean, people are now looking at this stock and seeing the momentum that it now has. So not only is it a value stock based on its low PE and high dividend yield, but it's now a momentum stock too, because it's going up. It's got momentum. The stocks that used to have momentum are going down. They now have momentum in the wrong direction. So the flows are going to continue to move into stocks like British Tobacco. And we're still very early in this rotation. It's got a long way to go. And another reason that investors are buying stocks like British Tobacco is because smokers are going to keep smoking even if the price of cigarettes goes up. Because if you're addicted to cigarettes, you got to smoke. And if smoking becomes more expensive, you're not going to quit. You're just going to cut back on other spending so that you can keep spending on cigarettes. And so in an inflationary time period, if you own a stock where the company has pricing power and they can raise their prices along with their costs, their margins are protected and the dividend can be increased, and that protects the shareholder from inflation, because as his cost of living is going up because prices are going up, his dividend on British Tobacco is also going up, so he's earning more money in dividends to help him pay higher prices for goods and services. Does it make sense that the same company that controls half of the online retail also passively eavesdrops on every private conversation? What about the idea that a single company controls 90% of the internet searches, runs your email service, and gets to track everything you do on your smartphone? Big tech is more powerful than most countries, and they profit by exploiting your personal data. Now's the time to put a layer of protection between your online activity and those tech juggernauts. And that's just one of the reasons I use ExpressVPN. So go to expressvpn.com/gold to learn more. Just think about how much of your life is on the internet. Sadly, every site you visit, video you watch, or message you send gets tracked and data mined. But when you run ExpressVPN on your device, the software hides your IP address so big tech can't personally identify you. ExpressVPN makes your activity harder to trace and harder to sell to advertisers. ExpressVPN also encrypts 100% of your internet data to keep you safe from hackers and eavesdroppers on your network. And ExpressVPN does all this without slowing your connection. That's why it's rated the number one VPN service by Mashable and TechRadar. But what I like most about ExpressVPN is how easy it is to use. Just download the app on your phone or computer, tap one button, and you're protected. Another benefit, in addition to privacy, and which from my perspective, I'm more concerned about the government getting my data than big tech, is the fact that I get access to content that might otherwise be blocked based on the fact that I live in Puerto Rico. For example, I have Dish, and Dish doesn't have CBS. When I want to watch CBS Sports, I need to use Paramount Plus, but Paramount Plus doesn't work in Puerto Rico, except I've got the ExpressVPN downloaded onto my Amazon Fire Stick, and that enables me to access the content which would otherwise be unavailable. So stop handing over your personal data to the big tech monopolies that mine your activity and sell your information. Keep your information protected and private using the VPN that I trust to keep my information safe. Just visit expressvpn.com/gold. That's ExpressVPN, EXPR. The one that caused a big decline on Thursday, which I will get to next. But the Friday carnage was directly related to rumors that were circulating and then later confirmed by a White House press conference that government officials around the world believe that Putin has made the decision to invade the Ukraine, and that the invasion could start any day. In fact, a lot of people expect the invasion to happen over this weekend, maybe tomorrow when we're all watching the Super Bowl. Now, so far, Putin has denied the rumors. He says that this is not true, that Russia does not intend to invade the Ukraine over the weekend. Now, of course, even if they did intend to invade, they wouldn't say so. I mean, why would you admit it? And then you basically undercut the effectiveness of your invasion. I mean, you want to try to take whoever you're invading by surprise. So it makes a lot of sense that even if Putin does intend to invade, that he's denying those rumors. Now, President Biden and Putin are supposed to have some type of emergency phone call at some point today. Maybe they've already had the phone call, I don't know, but they are scheduled to talk, and so maybe there'll be some new news on the prospect of this invasion by the time anybody listens to this podcast. But the important aspect of it was it had an immediate effect on the markets. I mean, the markets were weak, but not nearly this weak. And as soon as the news came out, we had the big drop in the stock market. But we had the opposite reaction in other markets, in particular, the gold market. Gold had a great day. It was up 1.9%, just under 2%, closing at $1,859. That is a $32.40 jump on Friday. Gold is now at a three-month high. Silver also had a strong day, up 40 cents. It closed the day and the week at $23.57. Gold stocks also had a big day. They were up about 6% as a group, although some individual names were up more than that. Although this huge rally basically offset most of the year-to-date losses in gold stocks. In fact, gold stocks got clobbered on Thursday. They did more than recover those losses on Friday, but not a lot of movement on the year, despite the fact that gold is now up 1.7% on the year. Year over year, the price of gold up 1.8%. Now, this is in sharp contrast to what's going on with Bitcoin. In fact, nothing really highlights the difference between gold and Bitcoin than the reaction to yesterday's news, because gold and Bitcoin reacted opposite of each other based on the exact same news. So you get some news, geopolitical risk, and as a result of that, the price of gold jumps up, but also the price of Bitcoin gets killed. In fact, if you look at the difference between GLD, which is the gold ETF, and GBTC, which is the Bitcoin ETF, while GLD was up 1.9% on the day, the Grayscale Bitcoin Trust was down 4.5% on the day. The opposite reaction to the identical news. In fact, year to date, that trust is down 13.5%. And on a year over year basis, it's down 40%. Now, if Bitcoin promoters claim that Bitcoin is digital gold, right? Some digital equivalent of gold. So instead of buying actual gold, you can buy this digital gold and you virtually get the same thing. If that were the case, then Bitcoin should be correlated to gold. It should act the same way. I mean, maybe it moves up more when gold moves up. Maybe it moves down more when gold moves down. But if it's a digital version of gold, then it needs to act like gold, not the opposite of gold. I mean, Bitcoin is more of an anti-gold. It's more likely to do the opposite of what gold does. So it's not digital gold. It's digital gold in reverse. What it really is digital risk, which means anybody who is buying Bitcoin because they think it's an alternative to gold, they think it's a safe haven or a store of value, is mistaken because it is neither of those things. And what happened on Friday proves it. And also earlier in the day, gold was already up. Prior to the news breaking of the Ukraine invasion, gold was already up. And the reason gold was up is because it was reacting to a much weaker than expected February University of Michigan confidence index. The January number was 67.2. And the consensus for February, and this is a preliminary number, so we'll get a final number later, but the consensus was for a slight improvement in consumer sentiment to 67.5. Instead, consumer sentiment collapsed all the way down to 61.7, way below the lowest estimate in the consensus, which ranged from a low of 65 to a high of 69. 61.7. That is the lowest reading in more than 11 years. And why are consumers so gloomy? Well, because the price of everything that they want to consume is going up. In fact, in particular, car prices, used car prices are now up like 40% year over year. It's an incredible increase in the price of cars, and that is why consumers aren't buying cars, because they can't afford them. In fact, within this survey, they report on consumers' intentions to buy a car, and that measurement is at an all-time record low. So fewer Americans are planning to buy a new car or a new used car than at any point in history. Now, what does that tell you about the economy? Clearly, it's in a lot of trouble because autos are a big part of the economy. And that's one of the reasons that these auto companies are getting killed. GM was down 3% on Friday. It's now down about 27% from its 52-week high, clearly in a bear market. Ford also dropped just under 3% yesterday. It's now down almost 33% from its 52-week high. It's deeper into bear market territory than General Motors. But what does this tell you? This is a big part of the economy. A lot of jobs are in the auto sector, higher paying jobs. And what does this mean? The economy is moving into recession. What is driving the recession? Inflation. Consumers are having to cut back on their spending because everything that they're buying costs a lot more money. And I will get to that in a little bit when I get to the inflation data that came out on Thursday, because I want to stick for now to what happened on Friday. But the point was, gold was already up on this news, which is bullish for gold because it shows that the economy is weakening. And a weakening economy is a dilemma for the Fed, which is now trying to fight inflation by raising interest rates. Because if the economy slips into recession, then the Fed may decide that it can't fight inflation because it has bigger fish to fry, because it's more worried about the economy. So any news that shows the economy is weakening is going to be bullish for gold, because it means that the Fed will be less aggressive in fighting inflation because its hands are tied behind its back based on weakening economy. And this consumer sentiment number certainly reveals a lot of potential weakness. Remember, up until recently, the Atlanta Fed was estimating Q1 GDP at just 0.1%. Now, they since moved that up to 0.7, but it's still very close to zero. And in fact, potentially the next time they revise this estimates based on some of this new data, it may well revise that estimate into a negative number. And if we have a negative Q1, right, a contraction in GDP, then we're halfway to recession. And that puts a lot of the rate hikes or potential rate hikes in jeopardy. And of course, that is bullish for gold, and which is why the price of gold was already up before the invasion news broke. Other markets that were reacting to the news, the US dollar index had a big rise. It was up about 0.5%. It ended the week just above 96, about 0.5% gain on the week as well. So pretty much all of the weekly gains happening on Friday. The index closed about 95.5 the prior week, but also a big move up in the oil market. Oil prices shot up $2.86 on the day. We closed the week at $91.42. That was down about 90 cents. Oil was much higher at one point during the day. It got as high as $92.74. We didn't take out the high from last week, which was $93.17, but I think we're going to take that high out next week, regardless of whether or not there's an invasion. But certainly if Russia does invade the Ukraine, then I expect a much bigger increase in the price of oil than if no invasion actually happens. But even though oil was slightly down on the week, it is up on the month. We're up 3.7% so far in the month of February. And year to date, oil prices are up 22%. Does that sound like inflation is slowing down? Like it's cooling off? Like we're going to get some type of rollover? No. All of the inflationary pressures are building. And in fact, those pressures are going to build even more if we get this invasion, which really highlights why the move in the bond market makes no sense, because we got a flight to safety in bonds. Bonds were down prior to this news. In fact, the yield on the 10-year U.S. Treasury was at 2.063%. This is the highest it's been since the pandemic. We're now solidly with a two handle. But after the news came out, we had a reversal. Investors bought U.S. Treasuries and the yields settled back down below 2%. We closed at 1.955%. But that still represents a increase in yields on the week because we closed the prior week at 1.93. Same thing in the 30-year bond. Earlier on Friday, the yields hit 2.353%. Again, a new post-COVID high, but we backed off and closed at 2.257%. But still, higher yields on the week. We closed the previous week at 2.233%. But my point is, why are people buying bonds as a safe haven when you also have inflation? Because there is no safety in bonds when it comes to inflation. And if an invasion results in higher oil prices, that puts even more upward pressure on inflation. If a potential war in the Ukraine causes the Fed to back away from some of its so-called inflation fighting because it's worried about the collateral damage to the economy and to the markets of this geopolitical turmoil going on, then that too is more inflationary. And inflation hurts bonds. So if you're in an inflationary environment, bonds can't be a safe haven. And I think this bond rally is going to be very short-lived. The real safe haven is gold, because not only is gold a safe haven from geopolitical risk, but it's also a safe haven from inflation. So gold provides protection from both threats. Now, Bitcoin provides protection from neither threat. Bitcoin doesn't help you with geopolitical risk, and it doesn't help you with inflation, as is being proven by the recent market action. But it's not just the longer-term treasury bonds where the yields are rising. You're seeing even bigger increases on the shorter end of the curve, and that's because, obviously, investors are pricing in a return to recession at some point during the term of these 10-year treasuries, and so they expect rates to move back down as the economy slips into recession. That's not going to be the case because we're going to be in stagflation and yields are going to be rising even as the economy is falling, which is going to create added problems for the economy. But think about this. The yield on a one-year treasury right now is 1.01%, barely above 1%. That is what you earn when you buy a one-year treasury. Now, that yield makes no sense because the year-over-year inflation rate in 2021 was 7%. So how do you lock your money up for a year to get 1% when inflation is 7%? Nobody's going to do that. It makes no sense whatsoever to buy a one-year treasury bill when the yield is only 1% and inflation is seven times as high. These are the yields that make no sense whatsoever. I mean, they make even less sense than the yield on a 10-year treasury at 2%, because at least people can believe that over the course of 10 years, rates are going to come back down because they're starting to think about the next recession and why rates might fall. Now, of course, that's a wrong assumption. I think anybody buying a 10-year treasury is making a huge mistake if they think that later on the yields are going to come back down. They're not. Inflation is going to drive them up. But what is the theory behind buying a one-year treasury at 1%? There is no way the inflation rate over the next 12 months is going to be 1%. I mean, even if the Fed succeeds incredibly in reducing the rate of inflation, let's say they manage to get the inflation rate back down to 2%. I think there's zero chance of them doing that, but let's say they do. If inflation is going to be 2%, why buy a note that only yields 1%? And in fact, if inflation gets down to 2% by the end of the year, it's not going to average 2% for the entire year. if the Fed manages to get inflation back down, only going up by 2% a year, by December, maybe inflation over the entire year will be 4%. Again, why buy a one-year Treasury obligation that's only going to pay you 1% if you're going to lose 4% to inflation? The yields make no sense whatsoever, and nobody in their right mind is going to buy this paper, which is why the yields are going to keep going up. The only buyer potentially is the Fed, and the Fed is threatening to stop buying. In fact, not only is the Fed threatening to stop buying, it's threatening to start selling. Good luck with that. From head to toe, your body is made up of trillions of cells, which are all busy performing their specific functions to keep you healthy and resilient. To keep up with all that work, a sufficient supply of an essential molecule called NAD+ must be maintained for cells to perform their normal functions, which includes creating ATP for cellular energy, repairing your cells, and supporting healthy mitochondria. Many common lifestyle factors that can decrease your cell NAD plus supply include alcohol consumption, excessive sun exposure, a poor diet, and even environmental factors such as pollution. True Niagen is a supplement that helps the cell's energy and can safely and effectively elevate your NAD plus levels, giving each one of your hardworking cells exactly what it needs to perform at its best. True Niagen addresses the non-visible signs of aging, like cellular energy production, and helps support heart and muscle health. And right, save 20% off. We got the release of the CPI number for January, the first number for the new year 2022. And as I speculated on my last podcast, the number came out worse than expected, meaning a larger number, more inflation. The consensus was for an increase of 0.5, which is still a big number, and we got an even bigger number. Prices were up by 0.6%, but the even bigger beat was on the year-over-year number. We ended 2021 with a year-over-year inflation rate of 7%. The consensus was for that to go up to 7.3 as of January. Instead, it went up to 7.5. That was even above the high end of the consensus range, which went from a low of 7.1 to a high of 7.4. 7.5%. We have already increased the year-over-year rate of inflation by a half a percentage point over where it was in December. The same news on the core. If you exclude food and energy, they were looking for core CPI to be up 0.5, again up 0.6. And the year-over-year increase went from 5.5% at the end of December to 6% at the end of January, a full half a percentage point increase. These are the worst inflation numbers since 1982. I think it was February of 1982, which was the last time we had a year-over-year increase of 7.5%. And by the way, in February of 1982, the Fed funds rate was 11.5%. Right now, it's basically zero. It was at 11.5%, and we have the same rate of inflation now as we had then. And of course, another significant difference between the inflation we had in 1982 and the inflation we have now is in 1982, even though we had high inflation of 7.5%, we were coming down because inflation was 13.5% in 1980. So we had already peaked and inflation was going down in large part because we had high real interest rates. If we had a Fed funds rate of 11.5 and an inflation rate of 7.5, you had 4 percentage points there of real yield. In contrast, today's 7.5% CPI represents an uptrend. We're not coming down, we're going up. We're going in the opposite direction, and interest rates are still basically zero, so real interest rates are minus 7.5%. So what's going to happen to a 7.5% inflation rate when you have negative real yields? It's going to keep going up. So the numbers are going to keep getting worse. We were improving in 1982. Inflation was on its way down. In fact, we had begun a multi-decade long decrease in the inflation rate. People called it disinflation because we had a constant ratcheting down of the inflation rate. That's why we started a big bull market in stocks and bonds in 1982. Well, now the opposite is in play. We are now seeing a major increase in inflation. This new period of inflation is just getting started, and that means the bear market in bonds is just getting started. That massive bull market that began in the early 1980s is over, and we are now in the early stages of an even bigger bear market because inflation is going to get so much worse. And it already is worse. Again, I've talked about the fact that we are not using the same CPI that we used in 1982. Because if we did, the year-over-year inflation rate would likely be north of 15%, meaning the highest inflation we've ever had. At the same time, we have the lowest interest rates we've ever had in real terms. And so clearly, the Fed continues to pour gasoline on this fire. But there's another reason that the true rate of inflation is much higher, and that's because companies come up with all sorts of gimmicks with which to raise prices without officially raising their prices. And I don't think any of these unofficial price hikes make it into the CPI. For example, Peloton, which makes these stationary exercise bikes, they recently added a $250 delivery and setup fee. Now, prior to that, the delivery and setup was included in the price, so you didn't pay extra for it. But now, instead of raising the price of the bikes, they probably raised those too, but now they add a whole new fee that didn't exist before, and so they can pretend they didn't raise their price, but this delivery fee is not going to be included in the CPI. And all sorts of companies are doing that. If you look at your bill, if you go to a restaurant, you might see an added fuel supplement or a service fee. Companies add processing fees, postage and handling fees. They add all sorts of fees rather than increasing the price. And these fees are not included in the CPI, but of course they're included in what consumers have to pay for the goods and services they are buying. You know, airlines have been doing this for years. I've talked about it on the podcast where instead of raising the price of a ticket, they just force you to pay extra to check your bags. They force you to pay extra to pick your seat. They force you to pay extra to get a meal, to get a pillow, and the fees to change your flight go up. Cancel your flight, go up. So when the government is looking at airfares and they're just looking at the fare and they're saying, here's the change, they're ignoring all the other ways that passengers are paying higher prices to fly on planes. And so what's actually happening to the cost of goods and services is far greater than what the government claims. And again, the most striking example of the absurdity is the owner's equivalent rent. Because again, if you look at the owner's equivalent rent in the January CPI, it's 4.5% year over year. That is ridiculous. Rents are up at least triple that amount, and home prices quadruple that amount. That's a third of the CPI. It's the biggest component, and it's so wrong. It is dragging down the index. So if we just substituted real rent or home prices for owner's equivalent rent, we would be well over 10% year over year right now. And why are we using a rent that nobody pays and not using the rent that everybody pays? Because the government is deliberately cooking the books. They don't want to report the truth. They report a lie. The problem is now the lie is so bad because in the past, when they lied about inflation, they were able to pretend it was less than 2% when it was more than 2%. But now it's so much more than 2% that even though they lie about it, it's still bad. Now, initially, when that news came out, the markets kind of shrugged it off. I mean, I would have thought there would have been a bigger negative reaction in the markets to that hotter than expected CPI number. But I still think a lot of market players are under the false impression that we've somehow turned the corner, that maybe that's the high watermark and inflation is now going to be coming down. And there's no reason to actually believe that that's going to be the case. But I think people are still a bit delusional on Wall Street when it comes to investments. Well, they got a real reality check later in the day. It was about 2 o'clock New York time when Bullard, he is the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis. He came out in an interview and said he wants to see a 100 basis point increase in interest rates by June, I think, or July, and that he wants a 50 basis point rate hike on liftoff. And in fact, he even talked about the possibility of an intra-meeting rate hike, meaning not waiting until March for liftoff, but to raise rates right now. And since the Fed has already said they're not going to raise rates until they completely stop doing quantitative easing, if we're going to raise rates before the March meeting, then the Fed has to stop QE before the March meeting. In fact, there were rumors that began circulating on Thursday that the Fed was going to have an emergency rate hike as early as Friday morning. And that really spooked the markets, and that's what started the big decline on Thursday. In fact, gold was down on the news. Not much, but gold stocks got clobbered. And again, why does the market keep selling off gold on the inflation data? And there was an initial sell-off in gold when we got the hotter than expected CPI. Gold did tank over $10 immediately, but it managed to claw its way back following that initial decline. But the reason that traders keep selling gold in response to hotter than expected inflation data is because they think the Fed's inflation fight is going to be bad for gold, that gold's going to be collateral damage because these higher interest rates are going to be bad for gold. And I have to keep pointing out that higher interest rates are not bad for gold. The reason interest rates are going up is because of inflation, and that's good for gold. And even though interest rates are going up, inflation is going up faster. For example, the increase in the year-over-year CPI just in January was 7% to 7.5%. That's a 50 basis point increase in inflation that wipes out an entire 50 basis point rate hike, meaning that if real interest rates were negative 7% when they were at zero, but now if the Fed goes to 0.5%, but inflation goes from 7 to 7.5%, real interest rates are still negative 7%. So even though the Fed has raised nominal interest rates, they haven't raised real interest rates. And in fact, the inflation rate is going to accelerate faster on a higher trajectory than the rate hikes. So even as the Fed is raising nominal rates, real rates will be falling. And that is extremely bullish for gold. In fact, any negative interest rate is bullish for gold. It doesn't matter how negative it is. If you've got a negative interest rate, it's bullish for gold, and interest rates are going to stay negative. There's no way they're ever going to get positive. And when investors figure that out, they're going to stop selling off gold on bad inflation news, and they're going to start buying it. And maybe they're already ready to start doing that based on the action that we saw on Friday. But that emergency 50 basis point rate hike didn't happen on Friday. But the odds of a 50 basis point rate hike by March have now increased. I think it's about a 70% probability now that when the Fed does get around to raising interest rates in March, it raises them by 50 basis points and not 25. But again, it's far too little too late because the increase in the inflation rate has already completely negated the entire 50 basis point rate hike. But I never really thought that we were going to get that emergency hike, because I think that would be very problematic for the Fed and the markets, because it would be an admission that the Fed got something wrong. Because if it has to veer from its planned trajectory, if the Fed has to have an emergency hike and cancel the hike that it had anticipated for March, that basically amounts to the Fed admitting that inflation is worse than it thought, and it is now reacting to being wrong and having to change its policy and raise rates sooner than it had planned and by more than it had planned. And I think that is a can of worms that the Fed prefers to leave closed. And so I think they're going to kind of wait and increase rates when they had planned, but I think there is a pretty good chance now that that initial hike is going to be 50 basis points, because since the market's now expected, if the Fed fails to deliver, that could be considered an ease, which would be extremely problematic for the Fed. And it would also send a signal that the Fed is worried about the economy because it's not giving the markets as much of a rate hike as the markets expect. But of course, the bigger problem for the Fed and for the nation is the predicament that we are in, pretending that what the Fed is planning on doing is going to have any effect on inflation. Because even if the Federal Reserve just raised interest rates to 2% today, it would still be an accommodative monetary policy. It's still a stimulative policy. Inflation is 7.5%. A 2% interest rate in a 7.5% inflationary environment is a highly stimulative policy. It is not going to do anything to fight inflation. Because what you need to do to fight inflation is you have to change people's preferences. You have to change their propensity to spend and borrow and increase their propensity to save and underconsume. And how are you going to do that with negative interest rates? Nobody is going to be incentivized to save money when inflation is destroying the value of their savings. Nobody is going to be incentivized to hold off on buying stuff when the price of everything they want to buy is going way up. The way you might refrain from buying something today is if I can put my money in the bank and earn a good positive rate of interest, then maybe I'll save up my money, earn some interest, and then buy some products in the future when they'll be cheaper because I can use the interest that I earned to help defray the cost of buying the product. But if I'm going to earn no interest, if inflation is destroying the value of my savings, why am I going to wait to spend? I'm going to buy whatever I can as quick as I can. The velocity of money really picks up in an inflationary environment. Everybody wants to get rid of their money like a hot potato. Nobody wants to be caught holding the cash. They want to get rid of their cash. And it's not just the consumer that wants to get rid of the cash. It's the businesses. That's why you're seeing this big increase in inventory. Businesses don't want to hold on to depreciating cash. They would rather turn their cash into inventory that they can sell in the future at higher prices. But also think about the incentive to borrow. When you have inflation, you create an incentive to take on debt because inflation wipes out the value of that debt. So inflation encourages debt. And when you borrow money and spend it, right, that's driving prices higher. So what the Federal Reserve is supposed to do to fight inflation is to discourage borrowing and spending and encourage saving. So if the interest rate rises to the point where you have a good positive return, like Volcker did in 1980, let's say the Federal Reserve raised interest rates to 10%, right? Inflation is 7.5%. If the Fed raised interest rates to 10%, that would be a game changer because now if you want to borrow money, there's a cost. If inflation is 7.5, but it's costing you 10% interest to borrow money, well, you're paying 2.5% real interest in order to borrow money. Right now, if interest rates are 1 or 2% and inflation is 7.5%, you're not paying anything to borrow money. In fact, you're being paid to borrow money. The Fed is incentivizing you to go out and borrow money because they're making borrowing money so cheap. In fact, they're punishing you if you don't borrow money. If you save money, you're going to get killed. But if the Fed raised interest rates to 10%, savers would be rewarded. Savers would be thinking, okay, yes, inflation is 7.5, but I'm getting 10% interest on my savings. That is offsetting the price increases, so I'm going to save money. That's what would be needed in order to bend the inflation curve. We've got to disincentivize borrowing and spending and incentivize savings. But none of that is happening. We are continuing to pursue an expansionary monetary policy. In fact, it's not just that we're pursuing an expansionary monetary policy. We are pursuing an expansionary fiscal policy. And all of these policies are all Keynesian policies. I'm not a Keynesian, I'm an Austrian. But all of the economists in government, at the Fed, they all subscribe to the Keynesian school. That's why they always want to stimulate the economy with deficit spending or easy money. Well, if you go back to Keynes, right, classic Keynes textbooks, you've got expansionary policies and you've got contractionary policies. And both policies are used under opposite circumstances. So when does the Fed pursue an expansionary policy? Well, when the economy is weak, when the economy is in a recession. and when you have low inflation. Because according to the Keynesians, inflation and the economy kind of move in opposite directions. When you have a strong economy, you have high inflation. When you have a weak economy, you have low inflation. Now, that's not true, but that's what the Keynesians believe. And so when the economy is weak, according to Keynesian economics, the government can help by stimulating with expansionary policies. Well, what are those policies? Well, you have monetary and fiscal policy. So an expansionary monetary policy is where the Fed is creating a lot of money, where the Fed is lowering interest rates in order to incentivize borrowing, investment, consumption, which of course we've been doing. Another type of expansionary policy is fiscal policy. Well, how does the government stimulate the economy with fiscal policy? It runs deficits. It spends more than it collects in taxes. So supposedly, it's putting money into the economy. And it can accomplish that in two ways. It can lower taxes. So taxpayers get to keep more of what they earn, and now they can spend that. Or the government can increase government spending, send out more unemployment benefits, more welfare benefits, stimulus checks, and now people get to spend the extra money that they receive from government. And all that extra spending is going to stimulate the economy. And the reason the government can do all this is because there's no inflation, because you have a weak economy, and so you can pursue these type of expansionary policies without an adverse effect on inflation because it's already low in this weak economy. Now, the theory is when the economy is no longer in recession and no longer needs this stimulus, the government takes it away, right? Like the stimulus, the government accommodative policy is a temporary measure. It's like a crutch that you give the economy when it's having trouble walking, and then it uses these crutches until it can walk on its own, and then you take the crutches away and everything is fine. Now, the other type of policy is a contractionary policy. When does the Fed use contractionary policies? Well, that's when the economy is strong, but it's too strong, right? It's overheating because now inflation is too high. And so what is the Keynesian policy remedy for high inflation? It's a contractionary policy because the Keynesians are focused on demand, and you want to use Keynesian policy to restrict aggregate demand, to lower demand, to rein in inflation. So what would be an example of a contractionary fiscal policy? Well, the government would start running surpluses instead of deficits. You would have tax increases, right? You would take money away from taxpayers by raising their taxes, and now they have less money to spend, so you've reduced aggregate demand, or you cut government spending. You give people on welfare less money, and now they have less to spend. So either government cuts spending or raising taxes, and that's what you do in an inflationary environment when you want to cool down the economy. This is all Keynesian economics. It's basically Keynes 101. Everybody knows that. Well, what is the government doing right now? Do we have contractionary monetary policy? No. Do we have contractionary fiscal policy? No. We have a massively expansionary fiscal policy. The U.S. government is running $3 trillion budget deficits right now. These are the highest deficits in history. This is a massive expansionary fiscal policy. At the same time, the Fed is running an expansionary monetary policy. Rates are still at zero. They're still doing QE. But even if the Fed stops doing QE, even if the Fed starts raising rates, the rate hikes that they have planned still leave the rate below the rate of inflation. It is still an expansionary monetary policy, and the Fed has admitted that. I talked about that on my last podcast. Fed officials are admitting they're not going to tighten money. They're just making money less loose. They are just going to be less accommodative in the future than they were in the past. But you can't fight inflation with an accommodative monetary policy, especially if you also have an accommodative fiscal policy. The ridiculous thing is the government right now is using a combination of monetary and fiscal policy that they would use if the economy was in recession and inflation was low. But they're using that policy under the pretext of fighting inflation. But they're not using any of the policy prescriptions to actually fight inflation. They're using the policy prescriptions that will make inflation worse. They are basically stimulating an economy that is already overheated And that's not going to fight inflation. That's going to make inflation worse. This is the problem that nobody wants to acknowledge. Because again, when the government stimulated the economy with accommodative policy, monetary and fiscal, they didn't give the economy a temporary crutch that it would use until it could walk on its own. Basically, that policy crippled the economy for life and made the economy completely dependent on those crutches. The crutches are stimulative or accommodative monetary policy and accommodative fiscal policy. The economy and the markets need both of those crutches to walk. You take one away, they can't walk. You take them both away, and the economy falls flat on its back. That's why the Fed can't remove its policy accommodation. That's why the government can't remove its, which is why inflation is never going to go away. Inflation is going to keep getting worse. This is a massive economic catastrophe in the making because the Fed can't allow this to happen, but they don't seem to have a choice. And that's why stagflation presents such a huge policy dilemma for the government, because the tools that the government relies on to deal with recession and the tools that it relies on to deal with inflation are opposites. You fight off recession with an expansionary combination of monetary and fiscal policy, but you fight off inflation with a contractionary combination of monetary and fiscal policy. But you can't expand and contract at the same time because those policy responses cancel each other out. See, the problem is under Keynesianism, stagflation can't exist. It's impossible because Keynesians think inflation is caused by growth. And so they never really provided for a circumstance where you had recession and inflation simultaneously, since they assumed that condition would never exist. Well, they never created a policy to deal with it, but unfortunately it does exist, and that's why we're stuck. So members of Congress, instead of just complaining about inflation, they should actually be doing something. Everybody in Congress is just looking at the Fed and blaming the Fed. And of course, the Fed shares a lot of the blame. The Fed is printing all this money and keeping interest rates artificially low. But it's Congress that's spending all this money. Congress is running these huge deficits, pursuing this expansionary fiscal policy, even as everybody is claiming that the economy is strong, that we have a booming economy, they continue to pursue this expansionary policy. They should be doing their part to fight inflation with a contractionary fiscal policy. What they need to be doing is cutting government spending. If the problem is too much spending, too much demand, how does the government do that? It needs to reduce spending, send less money to Americans so they'll have less money to spend. Or they could raise taxes. We have huge deficits. We need tax increases, not on the rich, but on the middle class. We have to tax the people that have a high propensity to spend, because it's the spending that's driving prices higher, not investment. So we need middle class tax hikes to reduce aggregate demand. But nobody in Congress is talking about raising taxes on the middle class. Meanwhile, they're complaining about inflation and they want to leave it all to the Fed, even though they're continuing to pursue an expansionary fiscal policy, which is only appropriate according to Keynes. And again, I don't agree with any of Keynes's theories, but at least according to Keynes, you only do that when the economy is weak and there is no inflation. Keynes himself would look at the current situation and say, you need a contractionary fiscal policy. We need tax hikes. We need cuts in government spending. But again, we can't do it because this bubble economy depends on all that spending, as it depends on an accommodative monetary policy from the Fed. That's why the Fed can't remove that support without the economy collapsing. Yet everybody in Congress is simply looking at the Fed to fight inflation, yet the Fed is pretending it's going to fight inflation with an accommodative monetary policy. Even if monetary policy becomes less accommodative, it's still accommodative, and it needs to be contractionary. Congress can't abdicate its responsibility and simply hand everything to the Fed and expect these tiny rate hikes spread over a couple of years are going to do anything about inflation when all they're doing is continuing to throw gasoline on the fire. Even if they're throwing less gasoline, it's still going to make the fire bigger. They think the way out is, well, we're just going to raise interest rates very slowly. We'll pretend we're fighting inflation, even though we're not, and we'll just hope the inflation problem goes away on its own. That's not going to happen. You know, they had the same philosophy in the 2000s when they were normalizing interest rates from 1%, where the Fed lowered them in 2002, back up to 6.5%, I think, or 6.25%, where they ultimately got in 2008. The Fed moved interest rates back up gradually. The Fed increased interest rates by 25 basis points every meeting. Now, why didn't they move rates higher quicker? Because they were obviously too low. And you also obviously had a housing bubble. At least it was obvious to me. It should have been obvious to the Fed. But rates were too low. They needed to let air out of that bubble and they needed to raise rates quicker. But the Federal Reserve did not want to do that because the Fed was afraid of the damage to the markets and the economy with an abrupt increase in interest rates, even though an abrupt increase is exactly what was needed. In fact, the problem was rates never should have been slashed to 1% in the first place. But once they made that mistake, they compounded the mistake by raising them too slowly. So the Fed left interest rates too low for too long, and that added air to the housing bubble. And so we ended up with a much bigger bubble. And so when that larger bubble ultimately popped, we had the financial crisis of 2008. Had the Fed acted sooner and not been concerned about the short-term negative effects on the markets, we wouldn't have had the financial crisis. Well, the same thing's going to happen now, only worse. The Fed should be raising interest rates much more aggressively, but it's afraid to do that because of the damage to the markets. So instead, it's raising them slowly. And just like the housing bubble got bigger, the inflation problem's going to get worse. Inflation is going to keep going up because the Fed's approach is too little too late to rein it in. But by the time the Fed actually gets around to trying to stop inflation from becoming hyperinflation, that's when everything is going to collapse. That's when we have a financial crisis on an order of magnitude greater than the one we had in 2008. That's when we have to come to terms with the fact that we can't pay our bills. That's when the government has to start defaulting on all of its promises, including its commitments to bondholders to pay interest and principal on U.S. treasuries. That is where this is headed. We are headed for a sovereign debt crisis. We are headed for a currency crisis. And investors are still completely asleep to this nightmare of a reality.
The Peter Schiff Show.